The most surprising thing about all these bomb threats against synagogues and mosques is that Trump voters actually know how to work a phone. It's 3 a.m. Friday, March 3rd, 2017. On today's show, comedian Louis Black and from The Late Show with Stephen Colbert, comedy writer and performer Brian Stack. We got a lot of show, so let's get right to it. Welcome to the broadcast. I'm David Feldman, davidfeldmanshow.com. I just don't understand why our Attorney General, Alabama's Jefferson Beauregard Sessions III, needs to recuse himself from that Russian investigation. I mean, when has Alabama's Jefferson Beauregard Sessions III ever so much as offered even a hint of bias or prejudice? He doesn't need to recuse himself. He has an open mind. And by that, I mean it's exposed to the air. Meanwhile, George W. Bush's ethics advisor shocked Washington when he called on Sessions to resign. This was shocking because nobody could believe that President George W. Bush had someone advising him on ethics. George W. Bush appeared on the Today Show Monday and said, quote, "America needs a free and open press to hold people like me accountable." "No, George, we need an extradition treaty with the Netherlands to put you on trial at The Hague for war crimes. That holds people like you accountable." Well, America's Cretan in chief delivered a televised address before a joint session of Congress Tuesday night. Things got incredibly ugly, incredibly fast when whoever was directing switched to a three shot of Donald Trump, Paul Ryan, and Mike Pence. I don't know if you watched the speech. Paul Ryan looked like Eddie Munster forgot to shave one of his turds. Trump, Mike Pence, and Paul Ryan wore blue ties. They picked the color blue to show solidarity with all the oxygen-deprived Americans who voted for them. Trump read off a teleprompter because a bad case of laryngitis made it impossible for Putin to dictate wirelessly into Trump's left ear. Beltway pundits gave the orange-faced, knuckle-dragging barbarian's speech good grades. That's because Trump somehow resisted the urge to hurl his own feces into the crowd. Trump got positive reviews for that speech because he has succeeded in setting the bar lower than Betsy DeVos's SAT scores. The Golem-in-Chief received several standing ovations, but that was primarily due to the Koch brothers making it way too painful for GOP lawmakers to remain seated on their asses for too long. Which is odd. You'd think people like the Koch brothers, being in the oil business, would be no strangers to lube. During Tuesday's nationally televised speech, the world's worst human being in recorded history promised to lower taxes and, at the same time, increase military spending by $50 billion. If those numbers don't make sense, it's because Trump just poached that Price Waterhouse guy from the Oscars. Then Trump came out strongly in favor of family leave. "Donald, why don't we start with your family? Leave." During his speech, the moldy hobbit with orange hair strapped to his head said in a few days he would unveil a new plan to destroy ISIS. Nobody's seen the plan, but I'm pretty sure Trump's plan to destroy ISIS is making Donald Trump its president. ISIS is a hateful organization determined to destroy families, ruining the lives of children with no sense of decency or love of freedom. Their sole motivation is to create terror. Wait, did I say ISIS? I meant ICE. ICE. You know, the immigration guys. I often confuse ICE with ISIS. ICE, those are the glorified Walmart greeters rounding up children because they're too afraid to take on MS-13, right? Okay. Meanwhile, defending ICE, our chop suey-brained leader, Donald Trump said America must enforce all our laws when it comes to dealing with foreigners. Mm-hmm. Let's start with the emoluments clause in the Constitution and all those foreigners staying at your Legionnaires' disease-infested hotels. In his speech, Trump blamed police deaths on undocumented immigrants. Wait, police are dying because of undocumented immigrants. Oh, so the NRA is run by undocumented immigrants. Because that's who's killing our police, the National Rifle Association. Well, Wayne LaPierre, that sounds like a Canadian name. He must be here illegally. Then our Neanderthal in chief announced plans to build his wall. Hey, Donald, instead of spending $40 billion on a wall, wouldn't it just be a lot cheaper for you to just insist it's already been built and it's working and we're safe? Trump concluded by saying America must put an end to division. And then Education Secretary Betsy DeVos shouted, "End to division? No problem." Welcome back. This is an amazing one. Lewis Black and Brian Stack. I thought of separating these two into two separate episodes. But, you know, I remember something Dennis Miller once said. If you have something sitting on your shelf that's fantastic, go with it. Use it all because you may fly into a mountain and never get to use all of it. So, you know, I was going to run Lewis and then Brian Stack on Tuesday, but I was getting nervous and I thought, what happens if I fly into a mountain before Tuesday's show? My last thought would be, you know, why didn't I put Lewis and Brian together on the same episode? I just can't have one of these episodes sitting on my shelf all weekend. So I have them both on because I was getting nervous. And I just wanted to put both of these interviews out into the universe just in case something happens. It actually has a nice flow. So I'm going to run Brian Stack. I'm going to run Brian Stack first because Lewis Black and I, we really went to town. And running Brian first and then Lewis, there's a natural current having Brian go first. This is just a great episode. I'm so proud of it. As you know, I'm calling it Black and Stack. I've always wanted to have an episode entitled Black and Stack. Unfortunately, Jack Black and Robert Stack are unavailable, so we'll just have to make do with Lewis Black and Brian Stack. I hope I don't fawn too much, but I can't help it. This is a great show, I promise you. The feedback from the Bob Saget episode, by the way, has been incredible. He's so fast, you might want to take a listen to that, and I hope he comes back real soon. Okay, I'm going to shut up. Coming up, Lewis Black and Brian Stack. Black and Stack. Not to be confused with Black and Stacked, a movie that got me through my divorce.
The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Wow. Brian Stack is a writer and actor. You know him from Conan O'Brien. I think he was there at the creation. He's currently on The Late Show with Stephen Colbert. He joins us from New York City. Hello, Mr. Stack.
Hey, David. Thanks for having me. By the way, just a quick correction. I started at Conan in 97, a few years after it started, but I was there for like 18 years, and it was a great place to be, but I started there a few years in.
So that's how it's going to be? Look, I'm really nervous interviewing you. This means a lot to me, okay?
Yeah, I know I'm a very intimidating presence.
You are. and to correct me right out of the gate, just,
I'm so sorry. I just didn't want to take credit for those early days when Louis C.K. and Dino and those guys were getting all those bits started. No, I would be honored to have been there from the very beginning. But,
yeah, but I mean, why do you have to fixate on a four-year mistake? Nobody's going to look it up. I mean, you're right.
And, I'm sorry.
And now I
that was
now,
rude.
Now I feel inadequate, and and I didn't check my facts. And so I have to be honest with you. I am intimidated talking to you.
Are you serious?
Yeah, this is the God's honest truth. I'm very, because this is originally, I wanted you to call in as a fake listener, because I do that with, you know, Eddie Pepper. People will do that, and it's fun. And I thought about you, and I rewatched some of your bits, and I thought, who the F are you to play with Brian Stack? How dare you even think? You know who you are? I mean, this is the truth. Everybody who's a comedy writer wants to be you. You're one of those comedy writers. You go, God, I wish I was Brian Stack. Do you know that?
Yeah, David, I can't tell you how much that means to me coming from you, and like just to hear that, I'm just incredibly grateful to hear you say that. That means a lot to me, I certainly, when I was coming up, you know, watching show people like Chris Elliott, you know, in little bits on late night or whatever, you know, just the idea of getting to do even a silly bit, even if nobody knows your name, you know, was kind of a weird dream of mine, and never expected to be able to do it. So I'm very grateful to have gotten to do it, and it means a lot that you've liked it. Thanks, man.
Oh, I cannot tell you the number of times that I think about who the funniest people in the world are and how I'm never going to be as funny as Brian Stack. If I had like 1/10 of Brian McCann's ability, I would just be so happy if I could be you and know that I'm as funny as Brian Kiley or Brian Dennehy. I'm sorry. who am I talking
about? I loved working with McCann for so many years. And he was, I knew Brian even in Chicago before. It's funny how many people I knew in Chicago originally, mm-hmm. including Brian. But it really does mean a lot. Thanks, David.
No, I was watching, and just most of my listeners are familiar with comedy, and they know who you are. But last night I watched the Conan tribute to you, the compilation when you died, and that,
right.
Remember you fell out of a plane?
Yes, exactly.
And the in memoriam that they prepared. No, they did when you left, they did a retrospective. I laughed involuntarily by myself, and I kept saying, I want to be him. I wish I could be as funny as you. Do you have a master's degree in psychology? Somebody told me that you actually have a master's.
I did get a master's, but it was utterly useless. Like, unless you went on for the PhD, it was in what they call, even the title doesn't even mean anything, it was communication arts with a psychology. It was basically psychology as it relates to media and stuff like that. And I went off to University of Wisconsin-Madison right after college, partly because I didn't know what I was going to do in life. But that's where I started doing improv. So I loved my time in Madison, but I had no business being in grad school.
Could you be a psychologist? I mean, if you have a master's in psychology, couldn't you have a couch and Kleenex?
Well, I guess it's like one of those things where it wasn't officially psychology, even though there was psychology was kind of, it was strongly related to psychology and how media affects people's thoughts and attitudes and stuff like that. But I knew as soon as I got there, I was like, what am I doing here? You know? But luckily I loved Madison so much, and I loved the University of Wisconsin, and that is where I started doing improv and on stage in front of people. So I'll always have a lot of affection for those 2 years I spent there.
A psychology degree in how the media controls. My daughter studied with Ralph Nader's sister, Laura Nader, at Berkeley. And she teaches a famous course about control, how society controls your thoughts. Did this touch upon Bernays at all?
You know, I don't remember getting into Bernays much at the time. It's been so long, but we did talk a lot about Chomsky and manufacturing consent, but also things like how the media can desensitize children possibly to violence, you know, mm-hmm. through just exposure to violent images and things like that.
You think that's good? I've been to your house, and your kids at two were playing Grand Theft Auto and Call of Duty.
Yeah.
You think that kids should be exposed to as much violence as possible, right?
Absolutely. That's why it's so funny too, because so much of the comedy I've done is so dark, and like, so like I sit there and I often think about you know, that line in High Fidelity where John Cusack's talking about, you know, people talk about kids being exposed to violent images all the time. What about thousands upon thousands of songs about heartbreak? You know, that just, what is that doing to us? And it's funny, too, because, you know, I think one of the things, one of the reasons a lot of dark stuff comes up in comedy I love and comedy I do, and I know you're the same way, because I remember some of the jokes, you wrote so many hilariously unusable jokes along with usable jokes when we worked together on the Emmys with Conan. I remember I was in tears reading the jokes that you deliberately threw in that we couldn't do. And so I know we both share the kind of same dark. It's our way of processing all the stuff we don't want to deal with in real life. You know, it's just like, oh, that stuff's too scary and disturbing, so let's put it into the comedy. And it's almost like a catharsis, you know. It helps you deal with it.
I lasted, I think, because of the jokes that never make it to the show.
I think. You had a Sophie's Choice Emmy's joke that I still to this day quote to people as one of those jokes that's just made for comedy writer rooms.
What was it?
Oh, it was... It was so terrible. I'm almost reluctant to even say it. But I think I could be wrong. I'm paraphrasing, but it was something like, as I look out over this sea of faces, I just want to say, take the girl. I'm sorry, that's what I think when I watch Sophie's Choice. It was something like that. It was just one of those jokes where I was just like, oh my God. You know, when you're in those rooms and you're, a lot of times the stuff that, especially late at night, that makes you laugh is the stuff that's the most inappropriate, unsuitable, dark stuff. And like, it's like Tina Fey's line about, you know, if you want to make most people laugh, you dress someone up like an old lady. And if you want to make comedy writers laugh, you have to push a real old lady something. And it's like, because I think we're all so, I think it's the inappropriate stuff that makes, the things that you can't possibly do. You know, right. That often makes people laugh the most.
It's interesting that you mentioned that, and I'm going to ask you the same question about this experience that I had. My seminal moment with comedy was watching Monty Python with my father. You probably remember this. John Cleese played a demented boxer who would train by rubbing gravel in his hair.
Oh, Ken Clean Air System. Yeah, I remember him.
Oh, man, you got a great memory. This is like the most important moment in my comedic development. I don't even remember the name. And he gets into a boxing ring with an old lady. That's the fight. And right. I'm trained, and my father and I are trained, that the old lady is going to beat the crap out of him. And he proceeds to pummel the old lady. And my father and I started laughing, like, hysterically. And I've never forgotten that was when I realized what real comedy was. Do you have a moment like that with my father where you were watching? Because I know
well,
that he...
Funny. Well, those early Python shows were hugely formative for me, too, like, in terms of warping my brain as to... Like, I still remember... Those very first episodes, you know, on Sunday nights they would show it on PBS, and yeah, those were so huge in terms of influencing what I find funny. And to this day, like, John Cleese was on our show this year, and I was like reluctant to even go down and meet him, but a bunch of the writers wanted to go down and meet him, so I was like, okay, I'll go. But it was like, you're always a little scared about meeting your, because he's like a comedy. One of the comedy Beatles to me, like with you. But he was very gracious and very nice, and I think he was very tired, but he still, you know, talked to us. And but it's very strange to meet people like that that you're, to this day, I'm still so awestruck by, you know.
You're pretty great. Well, you're not pretty great. You're pretty and great. You're amazing at improv.
Oh, thank you.
If you were thrown into a scene with a hero like John Cleese, could you stay in the moment, or would there be that voice in your head saying, who the hell am I to play with John Cleese?
I it's hard to imagine sharing a stage with him or trying to do something comedically with him. But I know Stephen to this day, or even Conan, you know, I think it's those people you admire when you're growing up, when you're a kid, that remain the most intimidating to you. Mm-hmm. Because, like Conan said, the most nervous he ever was, this was years ago anyway, he said, the most nervous I ever was interviewing a guest was when I interviewed Peter Falk. even though most of our audience wouldn't even necessarily know who Peter Falk was, but he was Columbo. He was the biggest TV star when Conan was a kid.
Yeah.
So he was nervous meeting him, or he was nervous meeting Ted Williams.
You know, I interviewed Peter Falk, and he was nervous around me.
Yeah.
He refused to make eye contact with me.
Wow.
I was making a joke about it.
Sorry. Did you actually talk to him?
No, I was.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm a moron.
That's the difference between you and me. My only gift is just to be an asshole.
You're an incredibly nice guy. And one of the reasons I always love is when nice guys have like a dark sense of humor. Like, that's the reason I love Andy Daly, too. You know, because Mr. Friendly with the dark undercurrent, you know, like.
Well, I interrupted you for a stupid joke, so.
No. I was just basically saying about, like, oh, yeah, people like Cleese and stuff. Like, I think it's hard to. To this day, I still get awestruck around, like, when Andrea Martin was on Conan, you know, it's people like SCTV, and, you know, when Martin Short was on, or Steve Martin, you know, people I idolized when I was a kid that still to this day kind of, or music heroes of mine, like.
Is it fair to say that Andrea Martin may be, like, the greatest? Is that a fair...
She's one of those people that, among performers who've worked with her or really have had any experience with her, she I think, is one of those comedy beatles for them. I think a lot of people, sadly, are, I should say, under-familiar with her, but she's... The people who know her have always considered her one of those money in the bank performers. If you bring her in on anything, she's going to knock it out of the park. You know, she's just.
She's still winning Tonys.
Yeah, like she's doing Pippin, and you know, she's in her 60s, and she's up there flying around on The Wire and stuff. And she couldn't have been more sweet and gracious. She was, I think there's still a part of her that she's like, oh, you. She was a little surprised that I even. You know, came in to say hello, because I think she's not used to being idolized like that these days, but she's certainly one of my heroes, you know, and Catherine O'Hara, too, all of those SCTV and Python people, you know. When Michael Palin was on Conan, he was on to promote one of his travel shows, and he was maybe the second or third guest, and I think a lot of our audience didn't even know he was had a comedy background, and I was like, he's another guy that, for me, will be in the pantheon, you know, and always will be.
This generation, the new generation coming up, just doesn't have context? Or is that always been the case?
It's a good question. I think it's maybe somewhat just generational, where you discover your own new people. But, you know, what I find encouraging is when people go back and discover, you know, some old thing, like, you know, like, there's still a part of me that thinks of Mr. Show as some of the new guys, but, you know, that came out 20 years ago, mm-hmm. which is still kind of blows my mind.
Right.
But that was one of those watershed shows for people a little younger than me. Those guys were, like, my age. So mm-hmm. I think of them as guys who, like Jay Johnson and Paul Tompkins and those guys, as being around the same age as me, and people that I love their work, but they were kind of my generation. But it's nice. I think everybody... I love when I meet one of our interns or something who knows about Python or knows about Billy Wilder or, you know, has a sense of history for comedy. Because some people just want to see the new Comedy Central show, which is fine. People should watch the new stuff. But I love when you meet people that are genuinely love looking back and finding the good stuff that might be 20 or 30 years old.
You're a fan of comedy. You can watch comedy and enjoy it.
Yeah, and I love when I meet young people who are maybe, you know, still in college, where I see it, I sense a real kindred spirit sometimes with some of these kids, where I'm just like, oh, you're this kid's like I was, you know. He's looking back and finding the Marx Brothers, and, you know, also finding stuff that's coming out now, but also looking back. And that's certainly how I was. I loved looking back at old screwball comedies, mm-hmm. you know, with Carol Lombard and stuff, just as much as I like the newer stuff.
What is your daily diet of comedy? Do you make sure that you watch something funny every day?
You know, it's funny. I don't know if this is... I've heard variations on this from other comedy people, but if I'm really honest with myself, I think I watch less comedy than I did when I was younger. I think there's something about it, like, I still really enjoy it and appreciate it, but a lot of times I end up being drawn more to drama stuff or documentaries. I don't know if it's because I work in comedy now that sometimes you want to just kind of go somewhere else. Mm-hmm. But I tend to watch, like, documentaries or, you know, I've gotten back into watching, like, college sports, you know, more than I used to. And
do you feel guilty that you're not watching comedy? Do you feel that there's a part of you that isn't watching comedy because you might be jealous, or it might just make you anxious, or you might steal an idea?
You know, some of that might be actually on a subconscious level what's actually happening. I think most comedians do feel that mixture of admiration and jealousy sometimes when you watch stuff. Like, to this day, like, if I'll watch an old Mr. Show sketch, like The Audition or mm-hmm. something
Dino
like that.
Dino wrote that,
like,
right? Dino?
Yeah. And I remember Jay Johnson telling me about that in Chicago before he even worked at Mr. Show, when Dino used to just do that as a stage sketch. And when Jay told me the premise of it, this is just riding in a van in Chicago, mm-hmm. I was like, oh my God, that's the most brilliantly simple. That I was so filled with admiration and jealousy at the same time, you know, where I was just like, oh my God, is that a brilliant idea? And that was long before I even saw it realized, you know, on TV. And so I think there's always that element of, and I've had musician friends say the same thing, where you're just like, oh, you know, there's always that mixture of admiration and also jealousy, not a destructive kind of jealousy, but more like a, oh man, that's so good. That's mm-hmm. so good. And I get that to this day when I, you know, even when I'll, like I sat in on a Comedy Bang Bang live stage show, you know, with Scott Aukerman and Paul F. Tompkins and Lauren Lapkus and Neil Campbell, when they came to Tarrytown, New York, where near where I live. And there's times where I just want to sit back and just watch them go, you know, like I'll just be like, oh, they're so quick and so good. And to this day, I'm still as much a fan as I've ever been. You know, I just don't tend to maybe watch as much when I get home after work, you know, because you've been thinking about trying to think up funny stuff all day, and you come home and sometimes you're just going to watch, you know, a documentary or a sports thing or something, or The Wire, you know, mm-hmm. or something like that.
But do you think it's fair to say that on any television comedy show, there are three types of writers? One would be the failed stand-up. The second would be the genuine writer, the person who's never performed and everything is on the page. And then there's the improv performer who's also a writer. That seems to be the three variables, right?
Well, a lot of the rooms I've worked in have been a mixture of people with a stand-up background, an improv background, and a strictly writer background. And I think that's a really nice, healthy mix. And mm-hmm. what I love, too, is a lot of times the stand-ups I've never done stand-up in my life, and I admire it more than I can say, just the courage and the artistry of it. I exclusively did improv. But I love that the friends of mine who I've worked with as writers continue to get up and do it right. when they can. And some of them, like Lori Kilmartin, will still go out on tour on hiatus weeks. And yeah, I love all those people. And Dan Cronin and Todd Levin and all those guys, like Josh Comers and all those guys, the fact that they still get up now and then when they can, even though it can be hard to, you can't go out on tour or whatever, uh-huh. same with you. You know, it's hard to go out on tour. They still keep their hand in, you know?
Yeah, it's gotten very hard for me to go out on tour because nobody wants me.
Do you ever not go on tour anymore?
I still perform. Actually, the podcast, believe it or not, has generated a loyal... I mean, anyway, let's not talk about me. So I find that stand-up comics who turn comedy writers are a little more possessive than the improv guys. The improv guys are much happier around a table in a comedy writing room, having fun out of themselves, part of the fabric, and not keeping score. That's what I've noticed. And it took me a long time, because I'm not an improv guy, but it took me a long time to go over to that side where you're just, it's all about the table, not about scoring. I suspect you came into it knowing that.
That's really an interesting observation. To be honest, most of the stand-ups I've worked with have been very collaborative, like in terms of like people like Dan Cronin and Laurie and all those people have been really love spitballing stuff around. But mm-hmm. it's really interesting to hear that perspective from you, because that may very well be true for a lot of stand-ups who go into writing. Because I can understand the sense of control you have over your own material and the fact that it's always exactly what you want it to be when you go out there. For better or worse, you go out there and you deliver exactly what you want to do. You have complete control. And I would think giving up some of that control and having it things get tweaked and stuff like that would be a real adjustment for stand-ups going into writing, you know, with a staff.
And with improv, it's complete lack of control.
That's true. You kind of have to, you can go out on stage with an idea, but you have to be prepared to abandon it immediately if it takes a left turn or a tangent, you know, that you weren't expecting. And it's all about kind of discovering while you're out there with the your scene partner or with the ensemble.
You studied at Second City.
Yeah, I started doing improv when I was going to grad school in Madison, and then I went off back to Chicago, which is my hometown. I always admired people that moved to Chicago just to do improv, but I was from there anyway. I don't know if I would have had the guts to move to another city just to do comedy, would have probably seemed so reckless to my with my Irish Catholic guilt-ridden upbringing. So I think I went off to... So I was basically going back to my hometown anyway. And so I did Improv Olympic and Second City classes, and then worked in a few groups while I was working in an ad agency for a few years, and then ended up working at Second City as a cast member for 4 years before working at Conan. I toured around the country in the touring company for a couple years, and then I was in one of the resident companies. And
So do you think Second City prepares a person for life better than stand-up comedy? I think having a Second City background makes you a better human being, even if you never get a job on the Colbert Show. I'm not so sure living the life of a stand-up comic for a couple of years makes you better. I'm almost convinced that in some ways stand-up can be a sinful pursuit in that it separates you from your fellow man, whereas, you know, when you do improv, it forces you to be part of the fabric of the universe. I think on a spiritual level, improv makes you a better human being.
That's a really interesting perspective, Dave, because, like, having not done stand-up,
I wasn't asking for your opinion on that. I'm telling you what makes a... Jesus Christ!
I completely believe...
Do you think I need your affirmation on this?
No,
human?
Well, that's basically what I was saying, was I don't even feel... having never done stand-up, I'm always fascinated by hearing the perspective of guys like you who've done it and have been out in that world, because... All I really know is the improv world and then the writing world. So it's always interesting to hear. I do notice that when I hear like podcasts like yours, or listen to WTF or something, where when comics talk to each other, I do get the sense that there is a really strong community and people do cling to each other and mm-hmm. form really strong bonds.
Yes.
That I related to as an improviser, you know, where you just, a lot of times the closest people, the people you trust the most are people you've been in the trenches with.
Right.
You know,
right.
Whether you're a stand-up or improviser, you know, to this day, some of my closest friends are people I met when we were all really, you know, kind of struggling in the early days. And in those trenches are, you know, Stephen Colbert still talks about paying for the bus with pennies once, you know, like everybody was really, you know, those early days in the trenches really do form a lot of strong bonds. And I'm sure it's the same with stand-ups. It's just a lot of times you're traveling completely on your own, I'm sure.
Yeah.
And you don't have that. Like when we would go do a show in a crappy van with the Second City Touring Company, you know, if a show went well, you did it together. If a show was a disaster, you did it together and you could kind of commiserate. But it must be very lonely at times being a stand-up on the road.
Did you see Birbiglia's film about the improv troupe? I forgot the name of it.
Oh, Don't Think Twice. Yeah. It was so... I was actually afraid to see it for a while because everyone... I love... Mike had been an intern of ours at Conan, actually, and Tammy Sager, and I love all those guys, Chris Gethard and Keegan and those guys. They're all wonderful, and like I was looking forward to seeing it, and I was also a little afraid to see it because everyone I knew who'd been an improviser, said he completely nails it and completely nails the dynamic of those groups and how jealousies form and how there's always someone who's doing better than the other people in the group, you know, and there's always someone who's more ambitious and there's always someone who is the unsung hero that holds the group together and is the glue of the group. And when I watched it, I was like, yep, he got it absolutely right. This is exactly the improv world as most improvisers know it. Wow. You know, it's very true in a very funny and also sad way. It's he really gets it right, you know.
It's called Don't Think Twice, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, thank you for, I couldn't remember that. I went to see it and I thought, well, I don't know anything about being part of an improv troupe, so I think this is fantastic. But that's probably because I don't know what it's really like. So I'm really pleased to hear that he nailed it. It must be very hard to have to be in an improv group and know that you should be surrendering and be thinking of the group, but still be a human being. It must be a constant struggle for some. Comics have changed. I don't think they're as competitive as they were when I started out, because I think comedy has gotten more personal. When I was starting out, it was joke heavy. So jokes are possessive. You know, I wrote a joke. I hope nobody steals it. Is he doing what I'm doing? Comedy, stand-up comedy, saved itself through Patton and Janine Garofalo by making it very personal. So you can't take it. Guys like Birbiglia, for example, will get up and talk about their real life stories. And it doesn't matter. Nobody can take what you're doing. I think it's a better scene than it was when I was starting out.
That makes sense to me, just to hear, even having never done stand-up, that really, that's a great point, because I do get the sense that, like, even with Louis's stuff, you know, where he, early on, I'd almost forgotten that a lot of his early stuff was very absurd, you know, and had nothing to do with his own life or his own family or his kids or anything like that. And to make that shift in what you're talking about, the truth of your own life, as opposed to just making, as funny as his early absurd stuff was, you know, making that shift, or, you know, Patton talking about his depression, or, you know, and making it so funny and talking about grief and things like that, that are, that's a very brave way to do comedy. It's very vulnerable, and it's also, it makes people feel a lot less alone about their own pettiness or their own grief or their own insecurities. I think that it's a nice thing to see the art of stand-up taking that. I think there's still room for a lot of just absurd stuff, which is great, but I like the mix, you know?
How deep do you get into your characters? Like, you're Trump, because this is what I've noticed about Smigel, and Smigel was, when he does Trump, I'm pretty sure he's Trump. I think half of him thinks he's Trump. How deep down will you go? Do you think like Trump? How are you getting there?
Well, you know, it's odd that I ended up doing Trump in some ways, because I never did Trump, you know, at Conan or anything. And I filled in when Trump was doing a call-in thing at the Colbert Show last year. They had me just fill in to have someone on the phone to riff around with Stephen and converse with him. And I kind of, that kind of morphed into me doing the cartoon Trump voice. In all honesty, I don't think I do a real Trump impression the way Anthony Atamanik does, who completely nails him, or Robert used to do him so beautifully in the Clutch Cargo bits on Conan. I do my best to kind of capture the you know, the petulance and the arrogance and the narcissism, but it's less of an impression than it is kind of an impression of his attitude. But when Robert, I'm also kind of doing it the way I sort of remember Robert doing it at Conan. I'm sort of just trying to, it's sort of doing an impression of an impression. Like Anthony, when I hear Anthony do it, it just is Trump, you know. It's so dead on, you know. You sit there and go, oh my God, that's just, and it's funny, my wife Miriam, Anthony, I bumped into Anthony on the street a while back, and he said, the first time I did Trump was in an ass cat scene with Miriam. And I guess it just kind of, I don't even think he knew he could do it. And it came out in a improv scene, and it's so funny now that it's like such a big part of his life.
Yeah.
But he really channels Trump. Like he even has the hand gestures down. And but in terms of characters in general, I've often see myself, in all honesty, as I remember John Cleese saying once of the Pythons, he said, Michael Palin's the real actor in the group. The rest of us are more caricaturists. Mm-hmm. And I've always kind of seen myself a bit of as a caricaturist. And that's not a put down. It's more like just, you know, you put on a character kind of like you're wearing a hat and you can have a lot of fun doing it. But I've always admired the depth, you know, when you see a really deep performance. Like when I watch someone like Fred Armisen or Bill Hader, at times I'm just like kind of awestruck at their ability to just completely transform you into these.
Courage of the commitment. Are you all in? Sure. I watch you, you're all in.
I feel like I'm doing my best to be all in, and I really enjoy, I've always loved doing characters more than anything, like, especially if they're completely different from me, you know, like playing like last week I got to be a crazy kind of Detroit Kid Rock, Ted Nugent type rocker dude. And, you know, those are the most fun things for me to do when they have absolutely nothing to do with my own personality or upbringing or background. But the odd thing is that most of the time, if you leave a sketch world like Colbert or Conan or whatever, most of the time they're going to get somebody who already looks and acts like that to play those parts. Mm-hmm. So that is one of the nice things about working at a show like this, where you do get to do some characters like that, whereas in a movie they would cast a guy who plays bikers all the time or whatever, you know.
When you're all in, and it's television, it's live to tape, it's it might as well be live television, what are you measuring? What's going on in your head? Are you listening to the audience? Do you know if you're getting laughs? Or are you in the character and the character doesn't care about the laughs?
Well, I notice it seems to work best when you're just playing the character and the intention of the scene. But there are times like I've noticed, and you probably find this too as a stand-up, when you're asking for the laugh, you don't get it. You know? Mm-hmm. You know that feeling where you're... Like, I always remember that old story, and it was an old theater's scene where someone had been in a play, and they always asked for the cup of sugar, and every night they got a laugh, and they said, why didn't I get a laugh tonight? And the director said, you usually ask for the cup of sugar, tonight you ask for the laugh.
Wow.
And I remember thinking that always stuck with me, because if you're in the moment and you're playing the scene, I think there's a sense in the audience where they can tell if you're pushing them to laugh. Like,
right.
But what if you're out there just kind of doing your jokes, and it seems effortless, and it's in the moment? It's like when basketball players are on a cold streak, and they're pushing to get the ball into the basket. That's when it doesn't go in, you know.
Right.
It's like when you're in a kind of zone, and ideally, what you always want to be in the zone. But you know, as you know, there are some nights where you feel like you are, and other nights where you're like, oh, I'm in a hole here. The audience can tell there's blood in the water.
Right. There's a thing that I've seen 10 times, and we've played it over the years, and it was in your In Memoriam. And by the way, I was very upset to hear of your death.
That was so sweet of Conan and Sweeney to do that.
Yeah.
That farewell thing. By the way, I don't want to interrupt. I just wanted to say real quick how grateful I was, because I was not expecting that, and they were so nice about me feeling the pull back to New York with my family and everything, and it was something I was not expecting, and it meant a lot.
So I've seen that. I must have seen this 10 or 15 times. People have shown it to me. I saw it. You're Frankenstein, and. And Tom Hanks is waiting in the wings, and there's a light switch.
Right.
And you're like selling the light switch like it's the greatest thing. Are you aware, like, people are laughing at your eyes, and are you selling it with your eyes, or is it just instinct? Is there any mechanics to it?
Well, you know, it's funny with Frankenstein, because I never would have probably even thought of playing Frankenstein, but Brian McCann originally came up with the idea for that bit, Frankenstein Wastes a Minute of Our Time, where he mm-hmm. just drags you down the hall with the camera crew and shows you something stupid like a light switch. I think my natural goofy personality came out in that character as much as anything I've ever done, of just like being a people pleaser. Like, look, it's like sort of bringing your report card home for your parents. So look, I look at this art project I got a B+ on, you know? And I think that my natural kind of goofy people-pleasing came out in Frankenstein. Like, he was almost like a little kid, you know, like, what do you think? Look what I found for you. Isn't this amazing? And Tom Hanks was so nice and funny. Like, he came up with the idea to get just as excited about the light switch as Frankenstein was, which, like, I used to hear that about him. Like, I don't know him at all, obviously, but Conan used to say when Tom Hanks hosted SNL, he was one of the hosts, one of the few hosts that would stay up all night with the writers and roll up his sleeves and just, he loves comedy. He just loves making things as funny as they can be, and he really, really enjoys the collaborative, fun process of bouncing ideas around. And I think that comes through in his work, but he was definitely like, I remember our cameraman tripped on the cord. That was a pre-tape when we shot that with him because he was so busy, and he's like, I'll do it again, no problem. And he goes, hey, how about if I get excited about the light switch? And, you know.
Wow.
So that was inspiring to see, you know, that he's still just kind of obviously a comedy fan and loves doing it.
Are we ever going to see a compilation of all the Conan stuff, or is that tied up somewhere?
You know, that's one of the unfortunate things is, like, I'm very jealous when I see that all the old SNLs are on, you know, Netflix or whatever, or on CISO, because I would love it if, God bless the people that put a lot of our old bits on YouTube, because otherwise they kind of just disappear into the ether, you know, I don't know of any plans to release the old shows, and that's kind of sad to me, because I think there's so much fun stuff, including the musical performances and the interviews and the remotes that Conan did, but thank God there are some on YouTube. Like, you can go on there and look at his 19th Century Rules baseball remote, which is still one of the funniest things ever, Triumph at the Star Wars, you know, premiere.
Did you ever see Conan's sketch? It was Aaron Sorkin and Tina Fey were both coming out with shows about Saturday Night Live, and Liev Schreiber was in it.
Yeah, that turned out so beautifully. I remember we were kicking around the idea of doing a Sorkin-ish type parody, and then I think Michael Coman and Andrew Weinberg were the main guys who ended up writing up the final version, and they got Liev Schreiber, and it turned out so beautifully. It was such a wonderful kind of
live from Studio 6A.
Yeah, that was actually, I think, one of the most beautifully realized pieces. Like, I remember when we were first just kicking around the idea of doing a Sorkin-ish backstage version of our own show, and then the fact that it was one of those rare cases where it turned out better than I even expected it would, you know, from the initial idea. And
The brilliance of it was, you know, they captured the walk and talk and all that stuff. Conan played a network executive.
Right.
Who was, you know, really putting the hammer down on Liev Schreiber, who played Conan. And they just amped up all the stakes on a stupid television show. What was genius about it was that Conan played a network executive who was fawning over Conan. So Conan got to fawn all over himself. Which,
yeah, I love how he's like, you're the full package. you're brilliant. That was wonderful.
That was the thing that I will always remember about Robert Smigel is last year we were in Cleveland during the Republican convention, and somehow we got Robert inside a tank as Trump. And it was Trump driving through a black neighborhood, and Robert was on a loudspeaker talking to the blacks as Trump.
Was he wearing the wig and stuff?
No. He was inside. He was afraid to go out and actually meet the people.
Oh, that's great.
Yeah, I'll send you a link to it. It is one of the funniest things I've ever seen in my life. Going through the inner city in a tank with Trump for president emblazoned on it, and then Robert's inside and there's a loudspeaker, hello the blacks, how are you? you're gonna have so many jobs, and most of them didn't believe it, and we were really worried about it because it was borderline, it could have been bad taste. And I was watching Robert in the tank, and I thought, this must have been how he was raised, because the power to keep going and doing it. And I said to him, you were raised to know right from wrong, and that sometimes you need to say the wrong things to make the right point. And
that's a great point. Yeah.
And I think parents really instill a lot of your comedic viewpoint. You know, I still ask my mother, am I wrong for going after ICE, you know, the Homeland Security, for doing what they're doing to the Mexicans? And then my mother starts screaming about Donald Trump, you know, get him, you know, you have to point this out. And so, like, I'm pleasing my mommy. What was instilled in you growing up?
Well, you know, it's funny. My parents, in all honesty, are pretty conservative people. You know, I think they would consider themselves Republicans, even though my dad voted for Kennedy and everything. But they don't like Trump, but they're pretty conservative people. But the sense of humor they've always had. But my dad was a military guy before he went.
Right.
He was in Vietnam, and then he left and went into business and stuff. But he
was the maitre d' at the Hanoi Hilton, right?
He was. Luckily, he was never captured, but he did get shot down in a helicopter and blown through a door by a shell and stuff. So he went through some stuff, but he luckily came home to us just fine. And they're pretty conservative people, but they always instilled in me a sense of kind of questioning things and having a sense of humor. Like they were the ones that oftentimes like turned me on to Woody Allen and, you know, the old movies. And so my parents always had a great sense of humor about things. So I think they kind of accept the fact that we don't always see eye to eye on things, but they also share kind of my irreverent sense of humor about things and questioning, not accepting things at face value, and digging underneath to through the bullshit and stuff.
Right,
you know?
Right.
So I think that's something I'm grateful that I got from them, even though we don't always agree politically. That's something we definitely share. And when you talk about like that kind of fearlessness that Robert has, you know, I've always admired that myself. When I don't know if I would have the, like when I watch like Colbert and in old Daily Show bits too, and he would be to someone's face playing the very position he was satirizing, you know, to make a satirical point. Or Robert, you know, I remember being at one of his, when he was doing Triumph at the Video Music Awards in 2001, I was standing right behind him and he was trying to get in to talk to NSYNC. And there was a wall of huge bodyguards, and Robert was pushing, trying to get past the biggest human being I've ever seen. And I remember the guy turns around and he goes, "Back off, man." And Robert's just like, "Come on, I just want to talk to him, and I'm just going to make some jokes." And the guy goes, "Can't make jokes with a broken jaw." And Robert was utterly fearless. Like, if it's something, if he thinks he's going to get something funny out of it, I got the sense he was willing to get physically harmed by this guy if he was going to get one really good joke. I'm not like that. I'm not courageous like that out in the open with people. Like, I could never operate Triumph out among people at like a Michael Jackson trial or something.
Right.
Oh, by the way, I meant to say congratulations to all you guys for the WGA award. Very well deserved.
Finally. Okay, our guest has been Brian Smith. I was waiting. We're done.
No, I was so excited for you guys, and that was so well deserved, and I was so happy to see, you know, the work you guys are doing recognized like that.
Thank you. Well, which is fantastic. Thank you. I was going to make a bad taste joke. The John Cleese moment with my father, watching him beat up the old lady, that was where I went, oh, that's what comedy can be. There's a moment in the past 10, 15 years where I saw the possibilities of comedy. Watching Triumph at the Westminster Dog Show the second time he went in. And I really recommend this because I don't know if you remember it, but he got thrown out the first time from the Westminster Dog
poster.
They what? I'm sorry?
They put up like a wanted poster the second time. Do not let this puppet in or whatever. I'm sorry to interrupt. Go ahead.
And this is when I to me, it's just, you know, there are certain points in your development, and this was a major part of my comedy development. Triumph, and I really recommend that everybody's, I think it's on the Best of Triumph on Netflix. So Triumph decides to go to the Westminster Dog Show in disguise as Ed Bradley. Do you remember this?
I forgot about the Ed Bradley part.
So he puts on a gray beard and
that's right.
The gray hair, and he goes, "Hello, this is Ed Bradley, not Triumph the Insult Comic Dog. I'm here at the dog show just to report for 60 minutes. No Conan O'Brien, nothing." And he's going around and he's introducing himself as Ed Bradley to all these people, but he's, you know, it's a effing dog, right? Well, near the end, as always, Triumph starts humping all the animals as Ed Bradley, and it gets really out of hand, and suddenly the beard falls off and the hair falls off. The beard is off, and then you see Robert's hand push the beard on the floor just into the shot. And it was just such a deconstruction of comedy. It was Robert saying, okay, I'm denoting Ed Bradley now. Right? The beard is in the shot, so Triumph is still Ed Bradley. It was like a virtuoso of comedic sloppiness where I thought, oh, you don't, nothing has to make sense. If you don't want it to, you don't have to explain anything, or even just a smidgen of an explanation can be enough for comedy. You don't have to overthink it.
That's such a great example. I love to when I think the audience always appreciates too when you're trying to keep it consistent, like the fact that you were shoving it in, like, well, this is the best I can do in this moment, and I think you're going to appreciate that I'm. It did fall off, let's acknowledge that. But let's just push it in to show that I'm trying to maintain a sense that this is still Ed Bradley. And those are beautiful. Like, some of my favorite things in comedy are when things go wrong and you just play with it. Like, uh-huh. You acknowledge that something. I remember slipping. I was playing God once at Conan, and I slipped on the stairs in my sandals.
And he asked if you'd been drinking.
Yeah, exactly. That's right. I think that ended up in the montage. And those are some of my favorite moments, because if the audience knows something just happened, so you might as well have fun with it and acknowledge it. And, you know, we a lot of my favorite, that's one thing you definitely, that I carried over from improv, and I know Conan came from an improv background, and Steven too. You know, if you don't treat mistakes like they're mistakes, they can be wonderful gifts, as corny as that sounds. It's like, if you just roll with them and have fun with the mistake. Okay, something just went horribly wrong. Mm-hmm. Let's have fun with it.
Whenever I have insomnia, which is every night, I listen to the control room tapes from Apollo 13. You can listen to them on YouTube.
Wow, I had no idea.
It's very interesting. It's Jim Lovell right as the service module exploded. And they're talking back to Houston. And it's just this calm voice. And I find it like, well, here they're about to lose three guys, and they are as calm as possible, and they got them home. That's how I view, I try to view life. Can you be funny around mean people? Because you're cursed. You've worked for Conan and Colbert, who are the two nicest guys in show business.
That's true. I've been lucky that way. But yeah, I try not to take that for granted too, because I think we've all worked around people that are have very negative energy and stuff, and sometimes they can be a healthy mix of personality types, because I think sometimes they can complement each other. I think good work can still happen even if people are very different personalities, as long as they're all pursuing the work with the same attitude, like they just want to make it good. Because like I worked on improv teams where some people just weren't getting along at all, but if they could leave it aside when they went on stage, it was fine. It gets a lot easier when you're getting along, because personally, I think a lot of the best stuff, the best material gets developed when you're screwing around in the office. And, and you don't want to screw around with people that you don't like.
Right,
you
know? Right.
So if you, like a lot of my favorite bits came up from us literally screwing around in the hall or in the writer's room or something. And if everybody's sitting in their own world, like in a really toxic environment, you're going to get less of those moments for sure.
I've been in toxic environments because I'm there and it becomes toxic. And there's a myth about comedy writing, and that is all of us are broken. This is what they say. to justify.
Yeah, I do agree with that.
Well, what they do is to justify a toxic environment in comedy. They'll say everybody in comedy is broken. We get our best work when they're off kilter, when they're insecure, when they're competitive, when they're miserable, because that's where comedy comes from. On the rare occasions where I spoke up, I would say, first of all, the human condition is we're all broken. There's nobody who isn't broken. The reason broken people turn to comedy is because they're incredibly broken, that the audience and comedy heals them. And they do their best work when they're feeling good. And by keeping them off kilter, you're just making them miserable. You're not making them funnier. Anyway, you've been...
I think that's a very wise theory.
What is this sketch show you're doing for Breitbart Television, the White Power Comedy Hour?
That's kind of a secret. I don't want too many spoilers to get out. We're going to change things for the better. I promise you that. And Bannon's got some a great chunk on all kinds of things. Oh man, it gets weirder and weirder, doesn't it? Like I keep thinking about I don't know how many people I've told this to, but it was funny when Trump announced that he was running in the summer of 2015. We hadn't gone on the air yet. We weren't going on the air till September, and I remember we were all thinking, well, this is hilarious. We got to do a web video because he won't still be in the race when our show starts. And to this day, I still think about that moment as just at how utterly absurd it was that the idea that he was even running again, let alone that he could ever be president. And
what do you say to people who are scared?
I think what Ruth Bader Ginsburg said the other day, someone was sending around a clip of her saying that she thinks the true symbol of America is not the bald eagle, but the pendulum, and that things swing back and forth and that they'll swing back again. And, that things do tend to shift to the right or the left, as long as we keep the checks and balances in place and we don't let the fascists completely take over. I think what Trump fears more than anything is being humiliated or made fun of. If we just keep doing that, I think that's the way to go. And I'm not saying that's going to take him down, because like people used to make jokes. We all know what a great role satire played in bringing down Nazi Germany. And I know that it's not like that's all you need. But I do believe that what he fears, and it's very clear just from the fact that he won't go to the White House Correspondents' Dinner, that his biggest fear is being belittled or made to feel less important or less great than he sees himself.
Narcissist. Yeah. Do you ever get scared? I mean, do you ever?
I do get scared. I get scared for, especially for, as a middle class white guy, I'm less scared for myself than I am for a lot of people I care about who, weren't born that way, and like just people that, and I get very scared for the country. I think most people I know feel this way. I feel so embarrassed, too, for our country right now. I feel so embarrassed just thinking about how people outside looking in at us think, that's who they want? Really? like that's who they want. That's who they want to be as their figurehead. And it's so embarrassing that he's our president to me. But I know a lot of people, what's really sad to me, I think, is that a lot of good people voted for him, too. It wasn't all like racist maniacs. I know there are some relatives of mine that I know voted for him, and what's really sad to me is they voted for him on the pro-life issue, which right. I know he doesn't actually even really
right.
feel that way about, and that makes me deeply sad, and he's a con man who conned a lot of good people along with the bad people. That's the saddest thing to me, is that guys like Bannon, of course, are going to want him in there, but the fact that there's a lot of good people in coal mining towns that just want their jobs to come back, and I understand that. He's the one that was saying, I'm going to do this for you. And he's not, but he gave them hope, and that's very sad to me,
I think the Democrats missed the boat. I think they won. I think Hillary won. Those 70,000 votes is another discussion. There is a problem, though, with the Democratic Party, because there are people who believe that abortion is murder. And you have to respect that.
Absolutely. There's a huge segment of people.
And I thought, actually, I thought when Bill Clinton was running in 92, he said, we can all agree that we want fewer abortions. The goal should be fewer abortions. We're all on the same page. I'm a big fan, and this was a little intimidating, to be quite frankly with you. Brian,
That's so kind of you to say, David. It meant a lot to me that you asked me to do it. And
are you kidding?
I really enjoy your podcast, and thank you so much for asking me.
How do people follow you on Twitter?
Oh, I'm... it's basically just, if they want to follow me, it's just Brian Stack 153. The 153 is utterly meaningless. I got assigned to me because I don't know much about internet stuff, but I won't even get into the explanation. There is no explanation. But if they want to look it up, it's just Brian Stack 153. Yeah, if they want to follow me there. And if people are ever interested, you know, the only other thing I do outside of the show usually these days is the last Monday of every month at UCB in Chelsea here in New York, I do a show called Gravid Water, which is fun if people ever want to come down and see that. Tammy Sager and Scott Adsit and some other people do it. It's improvisers and actors paired up. The actors have memorized lines from a scene, and the improvisers don't know what the scene is until they go out there, and so they have to just respond to each line that they're hearing for the first time. And it's a lot of fun. It's the last Monday of every month, including this Monday, and that's the only other thing.
At UCB.
UCB in Chelsea, and it's a lot of fun. Stephen Ruddy is the producer, and he gets some wonderful actors to do the acting side of things, you know, like a lot of stage actors from Broadway and stuff that give full-on performances, and the improvisers have a lot to react to. And
scenes from plays and movies that you would be familiar with?
Very rarely in my case. The only time I really... there were only a couple times where I recognized what it was, and I still didn't know what the next line was going to be usually, but there was one time there was a scene from All That Jazz that I was familiar with, because I'd seen that quite a few times, and there was another time it was Romeo and Juliet. But most of the time it's like, you know, plays by... that I'm a little unfamiliar with, by like David Hare or something, you know, and I won't know the scene at all.
So it's a nightmare. That is the nightmare of every actor.
It's funny because the audience is so on your side because they know it's kind of an actor's nightmare to go out there and not know what's coming. But the audience is so wonderfully supportive because they know you're just trying to make sense of what you've just heard. And as long as you're kind of rolling with it and trying to...
What a great idea. Support. What a great idea.
Really, it's really a wonderful... it's my favorite show to do over at UCB, and I love watching the other scenes because there's usually five scenes and you're just in one of them yourself, and then you get to watch four of them, so it's always a lot of fun to watch. And they do it in LA too, the first or last Sunday of every month, and I would highly recommend it if you live in LA too, just to see it at UCB Franklin. They do it there too.
Wow.
It's a great show to see or do. But
Brian,
I thank you again, David.
Thank
so
you,
much
Brian.
For having me.
Please,
do this.
You'll come back, please.
I'd love to anytime.
Oh, thank you. Thank you so much, Brian.
Thank you, David. Have a good day.
You too. Bye.
You're listening to the David Feldman radio program, You Sad Pathetic Hump.
Before we start, Lewis, I know you love me.
Oh, boy.
Yeah, and I know this is a big thing for you to come on my show, but the dynamic has to be that you're put out, this is an inconvenience, and you have to be the alpha dog in this, even though you've worshipped me for 50 years.
Well, 50 minutes. 50 minutes. But I did have to ask you to be on the show. That's what's astonishing. That I had to go out of my way to ask you to do the show. Because it's the only way I was going to see you. You know, because otherwise you don't call back. I get nothing from you. So I have to say, can we be on the show so I can see and talk? We can talk for a few minutes.
I've wanted to have you on the show. But, you know, there's a waiting list so long to get on this show.
I know.
I mean, and then now you've opened up the floodgates. Now that I've had you on, I'm going to get a million calls from Steve Martin and Tom Hanks.
Tom Hanks. Yeah, my close friend Tom Hanks.
Yeah, I mean, now I've kind of raised the standard, and it's not going to be good.
No, Gary Busey, I think, will call. I think Angelina Jolie. I mean, you're going to be set.
American stand-up comedian, author, playwright, social critic, actor, and publisher of Molly Aficionado, Lewis Black, joins us. Molly, every month I get your magazine on Molly, and it's fantastic.
My magazine on what the fuck is Molly?
It's a mind-altering drug that the millennials are
That's
using.
That's what I thought.
Yeah. How can you be the publisher of the magazine? You don't even know what...
No, am I the publisher?
Yeah, you are.
No, seriously?
The Joanne got you the job as...
No, I wish I had the job. I'm getting no money for it.
I'm making a fortune off your work.
But Molly Aficionado, that's not really... Is it a real magazine?
No, I just wanted to...
Oh, but I'm glad you made it up. And it makes me want to get a subscription. I mean, maybe we could do that instead of this bullshit.
Well, one of the questions I wanted to ask you is, what's Kathleen Madigan's phone number, and how can I get her on the show instead of you?
Oh, if I only knew. I was just talking to her right here, and if I could
have... Because I so wish.
Because I could have just hooked that up. I could have left my fucking phone here. And it's completely mofied, so it's the charge would last. You could do the whole goddamn interview.
Is she the... I think she may be one of the most underrated comedians working.
I think it's astonishing.
That she's not recognized for...
Yeah, the lack of... that they don't... No, you know, that they're not paying attention. And have them for a long time. And then it really in the last... You know, and then you kind of go, okay, there's this or that. And, but then when you watch somebody really come into their own, as she has in the last, you know, five years, let's say that's coming. I mean, I've always... You and I both have known her forever, so she's always been funny. But... Really, where it's like now, it's like bam, 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 bam. How do you not notice? How do you not? I don't get it. You know, but that happens to a lot. You know, there's others too that we could sit here and make a list of. Mm-hmm. But with her, it's really it's absurd.
Well, there are two comics. She and Todd Barry.
Yeah, Todd. Oh, yes.
Are just two comics who, when I see them on television, I say, oh. I remember I want to be a comedian. They make like Kathleen makes me want to be. I remember we were in Ireland and where she's beloved.
Yes,
and I remember watching her. And there are a lot of tough. Oh, you were there too. This was 2003.
Yeah, I know. I'm forgettable.
And
but we were two Jews, so which cancels each other.
Okay, I had some questions about Kathleen Madigan. You toured Iraq and Afghanistan with her.
Yeah.
Aren't there better places to go on vacation?
It's really unbelievable. Yeah, no, we had there are pictures that we've sent out and stuff from there. It was unbelievable. It was just, it was really, it was Kathleen and I, and you got to realize, and Lance Armstrong.
Wow.
Yeah, and...
So three dopers.
Three dopers. Kathleen's an alcoholic. And then Kicks Brooks, Brooks and Dunn.
Mm-hmm. But you must have got...
Can you imagine?
You and Brooks and Dunn.
Well, it was just Brooks.
Dunn was done.
And then there was... And Robin.
You know, Robin Williams.
Yeah. Mm. So it was in the, I mean, but we wandered into places. We went into a place called Qatar, Q-A-T-A-R, Qatar, they call it, you know.
The country?
Yeah.
Well, that's where Al Jazeera is from.
Well, that's where they were after we went there and I was able to organize some cells. it's a Jewish hours.
Al.
No, the... No, it's oddly enough, and we go there and they say, whatever you do, don't tell people that we have a base here. Nobody's supposed to know that we have a base here. what are you taking, you know, me, Kathleen, Robin, really, three schmucks, really? Yeah, we're going to keep it a secret. And like anybody believe us, uh-huh. And anybody believe that we went there. It was really the whole thing. We were really running around like idiots.
So was Rebecca Irwin Robin's partner?
Yeah, Rebecca. Rebecca
Spencer.
Rebecca Spencer Irwin wasn't there for. And she's smart. She saved it for the movies.
She traveled with him on those.
She traveled on some. I can't. No, she was there. You were right.
Mullen.
Because Steinberg came on one of them. So he's, and David, his manager. I mean, right. His manager. So, yeah, Rebecca was there. Yeah, that's true.
The former,
twice. You're right.
The former Joint Chiefs of Staff, Mullen, mm-hmm. said, I don't know, I can't imagine that Robin would go to any outpost as deep in country. if he said there are three guys, he would go.
Yeah, no, Robin was
unreal. Now, you weren't stupid enough to join him.
No. It was hard enough doing what we were doing. I was out of my depth doing what I was doing. He would do that on his own. I mean, he didn't do it when we were together. I mean, because it was, 14 shows, 7 days, 6 countries, that kind of thing. But he would go back on his own. And fly into these forward operating bases, as we like to call them, those of us in the street. And we would go, chopper into these fucking places. And I just, I can't imagine. I literally can't imagine it. But what was astonishing was that when he came off a plane, like Kathleen and I would waddle off the plane. It'd be like Kathleen and I would come off the plane as if we were going to be entering an assisted living situation. And Robin would whip off the plane at 100 miles an hour. And there'd be troops, like 8-9 guys standing around. And he'd run right up to them and just start. And so from the moment we hit the ground until we left, he was on.
Right.
For them.
And I think, Robin, I'm from San Francisco. He was built that way. The frustration that you must have felt is, boy, I wish I could do what he's doing with those soldiers right now. But my comedy comes from someplace else.
Yeah.
His comes from this love and neediness and hug me and energy. And your comedy comes from FU.
Yeah, my comedy.
And so there's no, it's hard to, don't you wish you could be that way? Isn't that?
You mean be the Robin?
Yeah.
Well,
I wish you were like that.
Oh, yeah, that's really.
In fact, I wish Robin were here instead of you.
Yeah, that would be
in every sense of the word.
That would be fun. It is too bad. I mean, that's the sad thing when you lose someone that you've known over time.
Yeah.
And you kind of then you kind of realize the questions you really should have asked. But we didn't get to do a podcast together, and that's really where the probing begins.
But you must have been able to talk to him about theater. You must have been able to connect with him.
We connected on a number of levels. But I have to say, I just can't imagine, because it's not just that drive; it's also that sense of being whatever. Because even through by the third time, I had a real sense of it. The third tour I did. But
you did three tours.
Yeah. I did one where I was. There was no Robin. I was the lead comic. I'm going. Is everyone dead? Because I said to them, "Can you please find a big name?" I was, "Come on, guys,
find
a really big name."
Right,
like Steve, Martin, or somebody, Jay, like just somebody.
Okay, hang on for 1 second, Lewis Black. You did three tours overseas.
Yeah,
I want to get to Robin in a second. First tour was what year?
I just 2005.
2005, and you went to Iraq or Afghanistan?
We went to Iraq and we went to Afghanistan. I think we were in Afghanistan then.
Okay, so that was 2005.
In Iraq, Afghanistan, and we also were in Italy that year. You flew into
Italy.
That's
insane.
Well, because you fly into Italy because there's a big Air Force base there.
Miso?
Miso's in Japan.
Oh, sorry.
I don't know.
And in Vietnam, it's miso horny, isn't it?
It began with an A. I don't remember. It was somewhere. It was like the greatest gig. I just stood on stage going, but you couldn't say this, but I said it in so many words. Who did you blow to get this assignment? Because it was a kid's show. It was the kids. Uh-huh. And I'm like, seriously? I'm what? Balloon animals? You got balloon animals, you fuckers? So we, but you flew in there because the Air Force was there. We also flew into Germany, where that the major hospital is, where they flew him out to that hospital. We went there. We went we went to Kuwait. Entered initially. That was the first.
And you were with whom on that tour?
This was Robin. I get on the plane. It's like way, and you got to realize. I mean, kind of. I'm not really. I'm out of my depth in just going now. But I'm also out of my celebrity depth. I mean, mm-hmm. I knew Robin. There's Lance Armstrong, who's so it's 2005. So you don't know that he's. You don't know that he's, you know, you don't, there's this, you know, there's some things right. about him cheating, but Kid Rock, mm-hmm. Admiral Mullen, the woman who was Miss America, whose name escapes me, I feel terrible.
Because you're a judge every year.
Yeah, well, I will be now that I'll be doing Miss Universe now.
Oh, okay, right. Now that Scalia is dead, you've been...
And another singer. I feel terrible. I don't remember what I had for lunch yesterday. So, but those were the you know this because that was really the it was the three of them and then so that was the first go around. The second go around was, I believe it was just me and no, the third was just me. It's tough to.
Okay, panic attacks? Panic attacks?
I didn't have any over there.
Yeah. Do they allow alcohol in the country? I know.
No. No, so we were sneaking. There was some sneaking around. You had to do some sneaking around. The Canadians had alcohol, so you had to kind of
be nice to this. What about Jews? I was told by somebody when you're in Afghanistan, Jew it down.
Oh, no, I was told that I just had to wear a chuppah.
Do you know this is true? Do you know that there were two Jews left in Kabul, Afghanistan? Did you ever see that story in the New York Times? The hardest I ever made Bill Maher laugh. It was page 2 of the New York Times. It was 2005. There were two Jews living in Afghanistan. I swear to God, I'm going to wait till you finish taking a sip.
Yeah.
Swear to God, two Jews in Afghanistan, Kabul, two separate temples. They would not worship together. I swear to God, I have to look it up. I swear to God, they said, I will not talk to that guy. And they accused each other of collaborating with the Taliban.
I swear to God,
I'm going to find that article. Yeah. I'm sure Jonathan Alper, who listens, knows this story. So the hardest you ever left, I would assume, was in Afghanistan. Why do you find drone strikes so funny? I would assume that's the hardest you ever laughed was in Afghanistan and Iraq, where a kind of laugh that you never had again, right?
Well, I was, you have that laugh. It's not a laugh. It comes from a different place. It's a laugh, but it comes from a completely different place.
Right.
It comes from a level of, I'm going to die. And then that follows. Because we were actually, every so often you would go, you know, holy shit. I mean, because you're kind of, you're with Admiral Mullen, so you're with him, so you kind of know there's as much protection as you could possibly have. You really would be kind of a toughie if they blew the Joint Chiefs out of the sky.
Mm-hmm.
And you're not in a battle zone of that nature. But it is still, you know, we were doing a show one night and there was a mortar attack around the whole place, you know.
And, what did you say?
Robin was on stage. He was good. Robin handles mortar well.
Did he leave? What did he do?
No, he was on stage. No, we kept the show going. We didn't stop. You never stopped.
I'm literally getting the chills. I remember something Mullen said about Robin. My friend Rebecca posted in Facebook that she saw Mullen. Mullen said, when he was talking about Robin's service,
yeah.
He said, there was no question that Robin was completely devoted to the troops, even though he expressed to me severe reservations as to why they were there.
Yeah.
And I get the chills when I think, and the way Mullen said that,
reminded me that we can trust people in the military, that the military, we have a good military. The problem is the people who exploit
them. That was the life changer in part. That was one of the 50 life changers.
Do you mind if I pursue this with you?
No, not at all.
Okay, because it's relevant, because I don't know if you had time to see the State of the Union on Tuesday.
That was yesterday, and it's already changed my life.
It wasn't a State of the Union.
It was the speech to Congress, and it was so moving. I don't even know if I could. It would be easier for me to talk about my time in Iraq and Afghanistan. That last night was a, I don't know for you, but a life changer for me. Go on. I'm sorry.
I don't know if you saw it because it's.
Oh, I saw it.
Because
I saw it. Because I feel obligated. That's because I got a gig coming up again, and I got I'm trying to shape the fucking shit I'm doing in front of people. I feel like I'm there with my stool, and I'm making little claymations. God damn it. You had to bring this up, fuck. I was hoping.
My mother, who loves you, always introduces his parents in the audience.
That's why.
always. Well, if I had parents like Lewis Black, I would introduce you. Loves you. And just so you know that I'm telling the truth, you and Colin Quinn.
Wow.
So she has great taste,
that's
right?
That's good taste. Yeah, right? And interesting. And the yin and the yang of it.
Yeah. My mother has great taste in comedy. Needless to say, I've disappointed her.
I'm glad you didn't bring the Writers Guild Award and put it between us. That I thought was very sweet of you.
Well, we'll talk about that later. That was a sweet night.
It was.
Yes. You did an amazing job. There's a line that... Can I quote a line?
Sure.
Of yours that... I turned to one of the writers I was sitting with, and I said, I could never have written this joke. It is not in my DNA. You said Kellyanne Conway.
Oh, it's not mine either. That was Bill Sheff's joke.
What a great joke.
It's a great joke. I had written the setups. I'd written all these setups, and I had a comment about Kellyanne. I'm not a comic as much as I'm a commentator, I feel. So I stumble into punchlines as I work through the year. I don't really, every so often I'll write it down. Yeah, I'll write it down. But Bill had gotten, Bill who's like one
Tell
of the-
Tell everybody who Bill Sheft.
Bill Sheft was the head writer of the Letterman show for 100 years and kind of a professor emeritus of the great joke writers of our time. He was working backstage with me, and his part of his gig was to help me with my stuff if I wanted help. And so I came in, and I went, wow, I didn't even know he was going to be there. So, Bill, do me a favor. Here's what I wrote. Take a look at it. And he added that Kellyanne Conway line. And that's a master craftsman.
That joke, can I?
Sure, please.
She's not somebody to run your political campaign. She's the person you hire to kill your daughter's
Cheerleading rival. Yeah.
But let's just sit for a second. She's the one you hire to kill your daughter's cheerleading rival.
Yeah.
Wow.
That is, and I remember hearing that joke, and when I was done laughing, because I'm an asshole, I said, I could never have gotten there. There's no way I could have made that. That's not a joke. That's a truth.
Yeah, no, it's a really, I mean, to the point... that night it exploded. I said to him, because he had three jokes, and they were all great, but this one was like, he said, what about that? I said, this is the joke, Bill. Look at this thing.
Right.
And he said, okay, if you want to use it. I said, I'm going to take it, and eventually I'll take, I said, and I'll tell people along the way that you wrote it. I said, because I'm really...
Well, you were giving him so much credit throughout the show. He's like, and you said something like, did he go to Harvard and he speaks fluent Greek and Latin or something?
Yeah.
He's that brilliant.
He's a brilliant son of a bitch. And he's a close friend with a great jazz artist, Jane Ira Bloom, who I've known forever. They were kind of raised around the same place. Yeah, no, he's really quite something. And but that line, it was. Let me see if I can get it precisely. It was, Kellyanne Conway isn't the person you hire to tell you what the president meant. She's the person you hire when you want to get rid of your daughter's cheerleading rival.
That is as perfect a
it's
joke.
It's perfectly constructed. Yeah. There's not a wasted word. There's not wasted. And it literally, everywhere I've been, doesn't matter, everywhere so far.
Right.
Five, six times. Same level of explosion.
Right. Because it's not a joke. It's not a joke. That's what's amazing about that.
And it also brings in the image of her. It takes into account everything about her.
Mm-hmm.
It really is. It's extraordinary.
Right. Those are...
Because I sit there. What's funny is, as I do it, you know that thing when you're doing... When I'm doing my own jokes, I don't... You know, I'm kind of used to the fact, okay. And they're not going to laugh. Okay, so we'll move on. But I do it, and I go, they're thinking. Ha! Right. It's like... As soon as you get to the cheerleading, right? As soon as you get to rival, boom.
Right. I have so much I want to ask you. I don't want to get into the mechanics of comedy. But the best kind of comedy is not... Well, there's all different types of comedy. But...
Marceau.
Yes. Which people so often wish I did this podcast the way Marceau performed. But I cannot tell you how... Do you know that I get my show, my listeners compliment the worst jokes I make?
Is that right?
The worse the joke. I love that when you did that joke about corn kernels and nobody laughed. I didn't think it was funny either, but I enjoyed your pain. But I think going back to stand-up, when I was really doing it before you were born, the biggest laughs always got not from how clever the joke was, but the amount of tension I was able to create in the room with a thought and then release it with something. And and that is a much higher art form than just ba-ding, ba-da-ba-boom.
Yeah. No, right? Someone told me early on, and it takes a long time to understand this, but that... comedy, quite simply is, and you put it, you almost to what it is, it's tension release.
Mm-hmm.
You create the tension in the room, and then the laughter is the release.
That's why I find podcasting for me has been the most rewarding. There's not an audience, but it gives you the room to create that tension and really let it hang for months before I come up with a joke. So I have an interview scheduled with Todd Glass in September.
Well, I thought he was coming in a minute.
No.
I thought you were going to wind us up.
No.
I have an interview scheduled.
No, kidding?
This was terrific, Lewis.
No.
Todd's coming in.
No, I just want to tell the listeners that in September of 2017, Todd Glass will be here, and that's where I will prick the bubble and a laugh will come.
Is that right?
It's worth the wait.
He's not coming until September?
Yeah, that's when I finally say something funny. Let me get back to the war. Because
is he really scheduled for September?
No, I'm just joking.
I love that idea, though, that he's got so much on his plate. It should be great, actually. I love him. I do. You're absolutely right. Todd used to do a show with my opening act for 100 years, now John Bowman.
Mm-hmm.
And the two of them used to do a duo thing that was completely psychotic, mm-hmm. that they were hoping would, of course, you know, you were in L.A. and you did it, and they were hoping it would become, you know, and then, of course, people saw it, and anyone with half a brain thought it was great, and then... and then the rest of them went, well, this will never work.
Right.
Yeah.
It's like Bruce Smirnoff's one-man show. Did you ever see that?
No.
Oh, okay. I have to get Bruce Smirnoff. All right, let me get back to the war.
Okay.
Something, you deserve a lot of credit. Bill Maher deserves a lot of credit. Jon Stewart deserves a lot of credit. And Stephen Colbert deserves a lot of credit. Because when we went to war in Iraq, unlike the Vietnam War, there were political satirists from the outset, within a year, saying, whoa, this is a mistake, or this something is screwy here. And that is the first time in American history when America went to war and the comics within less than a year were saying, nope, wrong. When, first of all, were you scared doing that?
No, because I did it right at the start. I did it from the time they started. I mean, this is a weird story. I was here on 9/11, and I was looking out my I was getting ready to see my shrink. Really.
Did he charge you for the missed session?
not until the end of the year.
Okay. No, okay. That, wait a second. That may be the funniest 9/11, the inadvertent 9/11 joke.
I know. And it's funny because I don't talk about it a lot. I was wandering around. There was a girl I was seeing at the time, and she was. I was wandering around getting ready, and I'd finally gotten the apartment, with the view. I had the view I had devoted, and it was kind of at the end of 42nd Street, and it was near the West Bank where I did a lot of work and continued to hang out. And it was, I finally had it. I finally had, I'd been in New York, it took 30 fucking years for me to be able to live in a nice place. I'd lived in shitholes. And I'm wandering around the apartment now, and you get that view, and what happens is it becomes wallpaper, so you don't really pay attention to the view. Mm-hmm. So I wasn't paying attention. And the girl I was with goes, oh my God, and she starts yelling. And she goes and turns the TV on. And that was, and then I looked out the window. I said, "What?" And she said, "The tower's burning." And I had a direct view of it. I was in Midtown, but completely clear view. Not you wouldn't have it now, but it was a completely clear view at that point.
It was blocking Staten Island.
Yeah. And so I could see it burning, and then. And then turned the TV on, and they started up, and I started, looking at the TV, looking out, and then the second one went, and this is what I thought, they are going to use this to do horrible, horrible things.
Really?
It was the first thought that I had.
Wow.
It's weird. I mean, it's not that I was. It really wasn't like, oh, I just felt it. I kind of knew it in my bones.
Wow.
I was like stunned. I said, they are going to do something horrible, even worse than I imagined in the sense. And then going out and doing those tours, and it was worse than I had imagined to what they did to these people, to their armed forces and what they did to us. But so from the very beginning. So I couldn't wait. So my take on it was different than everyone's was. The first joke I had was, Graydon Carter goes or whatever the fuck, whoever it was. This was the death of irony. And I went, right. Yeah, it would be the death of irony if anybody in America knew what the word meant. So that was day two. The death of irony. Fuck you. The only thing people know is they. And I was in, and so I was going to San Francisco, and that's where I told the joke. I said the only thing that people know is that somebody says something, and somebody goes, oh, "How ironic." That's but nobody knows what the fuck irony is. So except you.
I'm not so sure. were you being ironic when you said that? You said that very sarcastically. So, how did that go over in San Francisco? How soon were you performing?
Okay, so this is how nuts it was. This is how crazy I was. I wanted out, but it was money. I can't do anything. I know this. I can't go down there. I had friends who did go down there. I know I'm worthless. Okay? I'm not going to, you know, what am I going to do? I don't do anything with tools. I'm not great at that stuff. I never was. I'm not.
You know a good Rolex from a fake Rolex.
No, I don't even know that.
Okay, because that's why I went down. I'm sorry. Sorry. Wow. I apologize.
No, don't apologize. Don't ever. And that's why I love your work. It's the ability to mine and not care, really, that right. At some point somebody's going to hurt you for that.
And that's why we're doing this show in my mother's basement.
So I wanted out. I wanted away from New York as quickly as possible. I mean, it was partly out of shock, obviously, because I'm going, I devote my, you know, I mean, and the other joke comes immediately because of what I was thinking of. Also at the time, I said, I don't give a shit what happened to anybody that day. In terms of the people outside, the people who lost someone there, outside of that, throughout the whole country, I believe that at some point during the first 3 hours after the attack, the thought crossed everyone's mind, son of a bitch, this has really fucked up my day. And that was another joke that, and I would just tell it, and I didn't care what people thought. I didn't give a fuck. I knew it was true.
Right.
But I wanted out so I could go do something. And the only thing, and I knew that, and this was by the next day, and I was supposed to be in, I was playing Cobbs. Another, just a very well-adjusted man.
Well, you know what, though?
I loved working.
And has, I do think of all the people there, Tom is a tastemaker. When he helped shape the San Francisco comedy scene.
Then better than I do. I just had that kind of.
He had impeccable. I mean, he brought Kennison. Go ahead.
But he had great people come through.
He had
through.
Great taste. Yeah.
You can cut that.
No, it's good.
Please cut it. I don't want to get blowback.
Yes, okay.
From especially for someone that you admire, maybe two people.
We'll bleep it. That's funny. That's funny. We'll bleep that.
We'll bleep it. So I wanted to get out of there, and I wanted to go back. I wanted to go do comedy because I'm watching TV, and I'm going, "This is psychotic," you know. And I'm seeing, this is horrible. But I'm seeing Giuliani basically telling us that 12,000 people, the lies start. There are 12,000 people dead down there. Well, I'm going, no, they're not 12,000 people dead down there.
Right.
And then you're watching as the Fox News guy is getting in the way of the CNN news guy is getting in the way of the other news guy. You know, so all of the jokes that are occurring around it,
mm-hmm.
not the center, but around it, are coming to me like, shh. And it was the only way that I could deal with it, and I felt the faster we can get to the funny, or at least for myself, and I flew to San Francisco on Thursday.
I would assume.
And nobody was, there was hardly anybody on the flight, there was, you know, I worked there that weekend. And
were you able to... Were they laughing?
Yeah. Here's, this is, I think you'll understand it coming from there, but, and I understood it when I was done. I thought if there was anywhere else, anywhere in the United States, I would, and I think if I was going to Houston or, you know, somewhere in Florida, practically anywhere else, I don't know if I'd be excited about going. I had the feeling that San Francisco lives in a different time zone. It's 10 years ahead of the country on any measured scale. San Francisco is living, I felt this, San Francisco was already at the point that this didn't have to happen. It had already psychically occurred to them 10 years ago. A town in which that basically says, hey, you and your rules, go fuck you. We're going to have this gay community that is a real, live, living, breathing community. You're living way beyond, you know, it's going to, that's the explosion that might take these people to the next level. Mm-hmm. It's a horrible thing, but I felt San Francisco was already there. So if I could go anywhere,
right,
and say what I wanted to say, it'd be San Francisco.
So let's fast.
I literally walked on stage and spoke for an hour and don't remember anything that I said. W. Kamau Bell was there and said, and he was a kid wanting to become a comic, and there was a bunch of those young comics in the back. And he said it was I'm not blowing my mind. He said it was an unbelievable set. I wish I'd recorded it. I don't remember. And I remember, the only thing I remember was I did 3 minutes on the fact that Bush didn't show up in New York for 3 days.
That's sacrilege, right? I mean, that is the ultimate, at that time.
Yeah, he didn't show up for 3 days. Fuck him.
But that's, to have said that, that was not the framing that was going on.
No.
Everybody rallied behind him. I want to fast forward to Tuesday's speech before joint session of Congress, where our Neanderthal in chief had the widow, Petty Officer William Ryan Owens. He was a Navy SEAL. He died in a raid in Yemen that the Obama administration had recommended against, but Bannon and Trump said, do it.
Yeah.
Instead of going into the Situation Room, because there's no Wi-Fi for Trump to tweet, he didn't go there to watch this, what was basically a failed raid on an Al-Qaeda camp. Trump didn't even go into the Situation Room. There was a widow that he had in the stands. I think when he introduced her, that may have been, I think that could be the first in a long series of final nails in Donald Trump's coffin.
You think so?
I think this. I mean, there's been final nails in that coffin
really?
For years.
You think so? Why?
I think that was as bad as it gets for a commander in chief to exploit that widow.
But they all do it.
But this, especially since the father.
Well, that's the one. Yeah, that's the other thing. You know, that the father is big here. And I mean, that backstory I wondered about, because I was shocked she was there, kind of, and then what's going on in that family. I never liked her. I said, don't marry her.
Wow.
Well, I mean, what is the backstory? I mean, she went. I mean, I guess, he's the president. I mean, it's that whole thing. We do it out of form.
Well, the father is a veteran.
Yeah, and the father's livid.
Father's a detective from Fort Lauderdale, refused to shake or meet Trump's hand.
But Trump said that he met him, of course.
Right, and the detective specifically said at Dover, I will not meet Trump. Mm-hmm. This raid was unnecessary. And I want an investigation. Mm-hmm. And that's, I hate to say that's so funny, but there is an element of truth to the fact that, the father probably has a problem with the widow.
Yeah, but the thing about that moment, which is those moments, as much as I just think that if they would stop, if they would take all of the energy that all of the commanders in chief of this country have, and take all of the energy that they put into that kind of moment, and put that into actually finding real funds for when these folks come home and make their lives easier, rather than I just always feel it's manipulation.
You've got George W. Bush now. Going on the he's on the Today Show. He has a book out, Painting Wounded Warriors. And
no, stop it. Hmm? You have to stop now.
Why?
Because it sounds like the setup to it. Seriously?
Oh, yeah. He was on the Today Show.
How do I miss this stuff?
Well, there's so much coming at us on Monday.
Painting Wounded Warriors. You mean like he goes and he paints them? you would look blue.
Sometimes he puts aluminum siding sometimes.
He paints them.
It turns out that he's not a bad artist. There's a book out. He was on the Today Show Monday promoting his new book of
where he's painting wounded warriors, and it's for the Wounded Warriors Project, and they're really great paintings. During the
I'm supposed to trust you,
Alex, if you could print that out.
I'm supposed to trust your opinion of art. You, who have worked in comedy, barely understand and grasp your own field. This is a visual form.
Well, I mean, he's lowered the bar. So the guy choked, almost choked to death on a pretzel. The fact that he can not paint, you know, stab himself
but
in the eye.
But really, it is supposed to be good. Did you see him?
I watched him on the Today Show, and I'm going to confess to something. And I'm not going to confess, I'm going to ask you. First of all, he's haunted by Iraq.
Yeah, I'm sure he is.
He knows that that he screwed up royally, and he's committed now to, he's dedicated his life now to painting wounded warriors and raising money for them.
Good for him.
And there were stories, I remember reading in Newsweek, at the height of the war when he was defending it, he would go to the veterans' hospitals and meet the families and break down and cry and say, I'm so sorry I did this. I'm so sorry we did this.
Is that right?
Yep. And if you go back, you can see it on YouTube. If you go look at him, he's definitely haunted by the war in Iraq. My question is, I do believe, and maybe I'm a fool, that deep down inside, and this is why I hate Trump.
Right.
He's made me like George W. Bush. For that, I can never forgive him. That painting a wounded warrior is sweet. But wouldn't he be doing a better service to the country by saying, folks, this is how you end up invading the wrong country?
Yeah.
Why can't he do that? Then he would go down. If he were to say, here's the textbook, here's how a president ends up messing up, watch for these pitfalls, he would deserve to be on Mount Rushmore.
But they don't do it. You know, they were given, you know, those guys are all given the opportunity. McGeorge Bundy, there's that documentary about the Vietnam War where they talk to those guys.
The Fog of War?
Mm-hmm. The Fog of War. Yeah, the Errol Morris. You know, so we've been through this before. They don't, it's just not in their makeup. It's because, you know, I knew A, B, C, D, you know, if you only knew, and then we were given that information and that was wrong. You know, whatever it is,
And the problem is,
I don't know, you know, I mean,
the problem is nobody remembers, nobody has context or history. I think that exploitation of that widow will go down, if there's any history ever to be written, in a month or a year, depending on what happens with this Cretan in chief. It's the worst thing I've seen in my life. And I've sauned with Jim Belushi. I've seen some horrible things. This was as bad as it gets. Somebody said to me, I was on stage, and somebody said to me, where do you get off criticizing the widow? And this is what I'm going to get to my question. Where do you get off criticizing the widow? Did you serve in the military? And I said,
where were you? Like last night you did this? How fucking dumb are you?
And
you went on after this?
Yeah.
You really are. And let me take your temperature.
So where do you get off criticizing? And I said, that's not how it works, pal. The military doesn't get to criticize the president, the commander in chief. I do. I'm a civilian. That's our role. That's why there's the Mattis rule.
Right.
That's why the civilians. Anyway, aren't we better than we were during the Vietnam War? Aren't we wiser? The fact that we're criticizing this early and we recognize that leaders hide behind the troops, aren't we a savvier populace?
Sort of. I mean, you know.
Some
of us. But I mean, the fact is that. You know, you got to realize the generation that took us to war in Iraq was the generation that was, you know, basically the ones who should have been, you know, were supposed to be in Vietnam. Right. The ones who were supposed to learn the lesson from Vietnam are the guys who took us to war in Iraq.
Right. But they didn't go.
No, and they didn't go, but they, but also, you know, I mean, that was the thing. I mean, I had one friend there. There was so much info, you know, you didn't know early on, and then as it came out, you knew it. You knew it really fast. And then you also knew, okay, you know, from that, you knew, you just don't wander into Iraq. You don't wander into a, you know, you already did it.
Mm-hmm.
And what I said, I mean, the stuff, I was doing stuff already before that occurred. That was the, before we went in, I said, you know, this is a reverse domino theory. The idea, we already did it. It didn't work. Okay. Mm-hmm. The idea was, is that if one country went communist, they'd all go communist. Now we got a new idea.
Right.
The new idea is if one country goes capitalist, you know, they're all going to be, want to be democracy and be capitalist.
Right.
And I'm like going, first off, the other took place in the jungle. Now we're going to try it in the desert. I mean, it was like, and I kept saying things like, I'm willing to go to war. I'm fine. Just manipulate me better. You're doing a shitty job of manipulating me. Make better shit up. You know, I mean, the stuff that was coming out was insane. You know, him sitting, how the fuck? These people allowed, you know, he's, and Colin Powell, I'm sure, feels, but he's sitting there with pictures of stuff that, it, look, these are pictures, and I said, you know, they're carrying weapons of mass destruction. Or ice cream, asshole! So I was doing all of that stuff. This is literally before, before we go in to war. It was like, I'm doing it in, I did a whole bunch of stuff like that along those lines.
Weren't you scared? I mean, they were really, you know, Ari Fleischer, the president's press secretary, said you need to watch what you say. He said that to Bill Maher.
Yeah.
You need to, did you feel any
pressure? I'm under that tremendous blanket of nobody gives a shit when it comes to me.
They do. I mean,
they don't. They really don't. I'm kind of left alone. I'm like, they kind of see me as this, you know, he's wandering around, he's a big barking dog, let him roam.
No paranoia, Patriot Act, nothing. Never felt
a goddamn thing. Never even thought about it. So yeah, my only problem was in a club, you know, it's like, you know, the idea was, what if somebody comes in the audience? But by the time I was really in the heart of working that, I'd become a pretty good goddamn comic. Mm-hmm. So I had no basic fear of dealing with, you know, because the same thing happened to me. It was like, you know, how can you say that, you know, what are you doing? You know, look at what Dick Cheney's doing. What do you do for America?
Mm-hmm.
And I said, this is what I fucking do. Right. I make people laugh.
Right.
That's my gig.
Right.
His gig is supposed to keep us safe.
Right.
But I had a CD that was out, really, I was coming out just before 9/11. I was already screaming about shit, and we had to cut it.
Is this the worst right now? I'm trying to get a handle on where we are in American history. Is this the worst you've ever seen it? Because it does remind me of 2001. Things were okay, and then the Republicans came in and ruined everything. How scared should we be right now? How truly scared or excited are you? Are you more scared or more excited?
I'm more worried about my sinuses than anything else. Those are the things that's what I'm really worried about. Between scared and excited, there were sinuses. Yep. No, what I get scared and then part of me feels that what's occurring is that people have gotten, and I get crazy around it. People get really hopped up. You know, they've been getting hopped up every day, and I just keep thinking, God, we got to calm down because, you know, this could go on for quite a while. Mm-hmm. So it doesn't help if every day we're doing this. The joke that I have is if this keeps up, we'll all be, anyone down to the age of 30 will actually, in 4 years, will be in assisted living because they'll have exhausted themselves.
Yeah.
And full of, the full economy will come because of the people under the age of 30 who will be hired to be caregivers. And so, 'cause you're, every one of us is going to need somebody. He's going, no, come on. It's, come on. Come on, get to the breakfast table today. Huh? Try, honey. I won't turn on the TV. So we got to stop. Part of it is that it's kind of an energy that's not going anywhere.
Uh-huh. I asked my shrink. Did I interrupt?
No.
Okay.
No.
I asked my shrink.
I'm glad you see one.
Yes. Is it? By the way, what happened? Did your shrink charge you for the?
No. As a matter of fact, I charged her.
She called you.
Yeah, you bitch.
I need to see it. I asked my shrink, is it me or is it Trump? And he said, honestly, it's Trump.
Wow.
That he has succeeded in giving the world a massive anxiety attack.
Yeah.
And I think you're right. I think this is a ground game. He's not going away.
No. And it doesn't help. It doesn't help that that the Democrats have, Nancy Pelosi in place. It doesn't help that that they have Chuck Schumer. And we have no one, there's no pushback from a real kind, except from the people. And the ones that are kind of doing, you're at the mercy of, Lindsey Graham and John McCain.
Mm-hmm.
John McCain kind of like, but John McCain who wants more money for the military.
wants more money, yeah.
He wants more money than Trump wants. It's like, I just think it's what makes it weird is that weirder than anything else is that we elected somebody who's that the person in office is not an adult. That to me is the weirdest
thing. Did you see him coming? Did you think he was going to? Did you think this would ever happen when you were watching him walking through?
I really had this innate. The only thing I didn't put in the mix was the Democratic Party, I didn't put them into the mix because I watched him and I thought that just on his own, that were the things that he said, that my faith in the American people is that they wouldn't buy it.
Right.
I really thought that they were not, that it would disgust them to the point that they would not allow this to occur.
You were in Man of the Year, the Barry Levinson
movie. Years ahead of when it literally came out. That's talk about timing.
I've been saying that this Trump phenomenon is the type of movie Robin would make so that he could do something with Goldthwait.
That's funny.
Right? This is something Robin would dream up with Barry Levinson, make a lot of money. And then Robin would say, good, now I can go do...
Well, Man of the Year, I've said to people that it's a flawed movie, but I think if you watch the first 55 minutes of that movie says more in a sense about what's occurred now than what commentators were saying.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It was prescient, and a lot of it was... Robin and Barry already had their take, and then it was great because they'd let Chris and I, Chris Walken and I sit in and, what do you think? And, we'd throw stuff in or, we have a line here and there. But it was really, I think, a real sense of what has, in essence, come to pass. I just really feel like, I just thought that there would be people would not buy it, and the thing is okay, 9 out of 10 New Yorkers voted against him, and New York was and the state of New York is the city of New York is screaming don't vote for him, but the problem is the rest of the United States looks at us as assholes,
right?
So they can't trust a group of assholes calling someone else. We're going, he's the king of the assholes,
right? The city that was attacked on 9/11 said, don't invade Iraq.
Yeah.
Sometimes you need to listen to the people who've experienced the horror of 9/11 or Donald Trump.
Yeah.
But they don't
you did a great job hosting the Writers Guild.
Oh, thank
Awards.
You
really did. And they did a tribute to John Waters.
Yeah, which you can actually, if you go to the Writers Guild site, I think you can watch that tribute, which is well worth your time because it is.
He's amazing.
If you're a young writer, it's well worth watching it because he says a great, great deal about writing from someone who is really totally off the, still in a sense off the charts as a creator, not someone you go, oh, you know, I mean, there's everyone's got a path, but his was like coming out of Baltimore.
That's what I wanted to ask you.
Yeah.
So Mr. Simon from The Wire, who used to be a journalist,
right? Yeah.
And then he created The Wire. Now he's doing The Deuce.
Yeah. No jobs for me.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. One would think.
He's from Maryland. Mary yeah. Levinson is from Maryland. And you're from Maryland.
And
is there a Maryland mafia? Are there a group of artists from Maryland who are dedicated to the Baltimore area? And if so, why?
Well, I come from Silver Spring, as does Goldie Hawn.
Okay.
I think I've said this before. It leads into my, I've said this time and again, that when they look back at the you know, 300 years from now, and they look back at where did the great minds come from, but they will be stunned by the preponderance of how many came from Maryland. Barry, it's just, you know, part of it is that it was a, if you look at Barry, John, David, I think part of it is this, it was a real community. So there was a real sense of place. And then, so you got people who have, you know, kind of come out of that. And then it's also in this kind of a completely wacky, you know, it was like treated like a city you drive through.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, you have this...
You're close to D.C.,
yeah.
You're close to New York, you're influenced.
You're influenced by it, but you're also, you know, you had, that was where the hot strip clubs were in Baltimore. So you had that, you had a seedy side there where John probably, you know, kind of stumbled into, and then you had that whole, you know, this, you know, what became more and more of a horrifying urban, you know, a... the ghettoization of Baltimore, so you have David Simon can come into that. And Barry, you know, Barry comes up with Diner, and Barry, you know, Barry, you know, and then he did another movie later on about that, about being...
Yeah, Kevin Pollak was in it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so you've got that sense of a place,
mm-hmm.
you know, that Baltimore seems to have.
Right.
More so than D.C., and the reason you don't see it out of D.C. is every 4 to 8 years... it's a whole different town.
Mm-hmm.
The whole taste changed, and comes the next guy or the next woman or, you know, the next person, and boom, you got a whole different... restaurants change, everything changes, tastes change.
Your proximity, growing up so close to Washington, D.C.,
mm-hmm.
you couldn't shake that from your art. You ended up going to Yale Drama School.
Right.
You're an accomplished playwright. You, when we were starting out, you were a dilettante. You were not really committed to stand-up comedy.
No, not at all.
You were somebody who was, as I recall, I think you mentioned the West Bank.
Yeah.
Some theater.
Yeah, I ran a theater that was in the basement of a restaurant.
And then you would introduce the shows and get laughs, but you were committed to grinding out
yeah.
plays. And then I heard about you through Robin Horden, who
oh,
ran
yeah.
the Harvard
yeah.
Catcher Rising
yeah,
Star.
Yeah, great room. One of the great, great rooms.
And he was one of the great men.
Yeah.
He was one of the guys who nurtured political humorists.
Yeah.
He was an air traffic controller fired by Reagan, was a union guy, hated Reagan. If you had an act that was anti-Reagan, you
yeah.
were booked.
And Barry. Barry. And that's Barry's, I think, home base.
Barry Crimmins.
Yeah.
And I'll get to that in a second. So what I remember about you, and maybe Charlie Hill, do you remember Charlie Hill? He was a Native American comedian.
Mm-hmm.
He used to work for Peltz, as I remember. Sorry. I'm sorry. He's a very sweet guy.
Wow.
Maybe he told me when my father died.
Wow.
He's a sweet guy. I remember when my father died, he told me to write my father's name down on a piece of paper. and then set it on fire, and that's what the so and I did it,
and the apartment burned down. as you sat on your couch weeping.
But my recollection of you, and this would be mid-90s,
yeah,
was you were not really into stand-up. You were a playwright who got up and did stand-up as a lark, but you didn't develop in the generic comedy clubs that came out of the boom in the 80s. Is that a fair statement?
Yeah. And no, absolutely. I developed my act totally in the West Bank.
In the West Bank?
Yeah. Not, I mean, I'd done other stuff, you know, on and off, but I never worked clubs. I'd gone to Catch in New York, and I went to... I wasn't going to stand online.
Okay, this is Alex. This is where it gets really. Do you have time?
Sure.
You sure? Okay, this is where.
If I had a life.
Okay, this is where it's going to get really good. Not that it hasn't been fantastic, but this is. Okay, so you developed an act that would not play in those generic comedy clubs during the boom. You would, if you had to go work the road and do political humor.
But I wasn't doing totally political, but I was doing a chunk of it. It was always a bit of it. But I wasn't, my real problem was is that, you know, in the 80s, part of it was is I had no interest in, I had an interest kind of going in and seeing what it was like, and I loved comics.
Stand-up.
Yeah, I love watching comics. I mean, I would go in, I mean, I'll never forget, you know, we were on 42nd Street. It's still there, the West Bank. There's still a theater there. And we go, I go around the corner. The Improv was on like 45th or something, mm-hmm. 46th. And occasionally, rarely, you know, would stumble up there and watch a show. Gilbert Gottfried. I saw Gilbert for the first time. It was life, you know, and that was like one of those life changes. Like, wow. Right. And this is what I thought. It's 12:30 at night. He's fucking spectacular.
Mm-hmm.
There are 8 people in the room. That's your last act? you're fucking him that hard? He is this good, and he's going last? Fuck you. And I said to him, that was where he was. That was where he was in the lineup. I'm going, oh, well, fuck this shit. These idiots don't know anything about comedy. And because I was working with people who, where I would work, you know, there were people like my friend John Bowman, who'd been a comic and now was acting in New York and used the room to do stand-up in. And the stand-ups that I kind of knew around, Bill Masters, who was left New York to become a writer in Los Angeles. Eventually, he came in. There was all sorts of people.
Did stand-up, this is how I think you experienced stand-up.
Right.
As a playwright and a performer, you would go to the Improv and see tremendous freedom that was not available anywhere else. But then when you explored stand-up, you realized that there wasn't as much freedom because the audience dictates a certain type of comedy unless you're famous.
Wow, I didn't really... I was so outside of the clubs, it didn't even strike me. You know, that... I was doing it on the side as kind of a hobby,
mm-hmm.
and my problem has always been, my problem with theater was the artistic directors. My problem in the clubs, like,
right,
was well, you're going to come in to Catch. This is what happened to Catch. I go in. I'm going to audition to Catch. This is my first foray, and it's mid 80s, late 80s, and not just to see really what it's like, and I get I'm 5th, 12th, 10th. It was even earlier than that because I hadn't really even, I just had started at the West Bank, and I had to pay for like 5 friends of mine to come, and I was broke, and they came in, and there was like 15 people in the club. It was an open mic night, like a Monday, and it was like, you know, 10:30 or something, 11.
Were you nervous?
Not really.
Because you had been doing it.
I'd been doing it on and off, and I only had to do
that. But like, in front of theater crowds.
Yeah. But I'd also been doing like, and also I only had to do 7 minutes, and I had 7 minutes. I was doing like 25, 30 minutes. I was doing 30 minutes with, I had 7 minutes. I'm like covering the other 23. I would go in to, I would say I'm going to work one night at a theater and get a theater for free and say, you know, that because they were open and I knew people and, I, you know, okay, 30, 40 of my friends, 30, 40, 50 people that I knew from the theater community come over to watch me do it. And I would get on stage and just have my list of notes and talk for an hour about stuff.
And for what purpose?
Just to get a sense of stand-up. Okay. And also, it was a way in which, at the time I didn't realize this, I could get my writing out there without having it to go through. You write a play and you can wait 2 years until you hear back. This was, gee, I'd like to talk about this, this, and this. Okay, I'll go in there and do this.
Yale Drama School.
Yeah.
What did you study at Yale Drama School?
Playwriting.
Playwriting.
Yeah. And I studied as an undergrad.
So you went to Yale Drama School to study playwriting.
Yeah.
The politics. Did you intend to shake the politics, or did it just stay with you? Were you, did you want to write about things other than, and you, I know that you have written about things other than politics. Is politics, government, something that, for me, I wish I could shake it.
Yeah.
Is it something you wish you could shake, but it just, no, I mean, part
I,
of you?
Well, I mean, I stayed away from it from a long time, for a long time. I was known as a political comic, and I was only doing 10 minutes of politics, you know, which was still a lot at the time. But it was, I mean, what I did do, you know, from the beginning, especially at Yale, was be like, you know, the election was coming or something, or they'd be running. You know, I would take, I wrote, and they would say, nobody's playing the cabaret this weekend, would you do it? And I would do an hour, a 45-minute show, and I had...
How'd you memorize it?
I didn't. I would. I didn't, never memorized anything.
So how would you do it?
I'd just talk.
Did you tape it?
No. You supposed to?
I don't know.
No, I didn't. I just got up. I had an outline of what I was going to talk about, and then some of it I would write. I mean, so oddly, you know, this is how, you know, this is when I was going there. Henry Scoop Jackson is running for office, so I wrote. I wrote all of these. I wrote every presidential candidate's speech. Mm-hmm. So I wrote all the speeches, and then get up and I'd read the speech, and then throw it off the thing, and then I'd go talk about something else, and I'd come back and talk about another candidate, and then the next after I worked that night, that, you know, they were stuck with me, those fuckers, because they had nobody to work the room, and they needed to fill the room so that they could do whatever the fuck. I didn't make any money off of it, you know, the school did. So the next, so I would do that, and then the next night I'd come back and go, oh, and I had friends of mine that go, you should do this first, try that there, and then I would replace the stuff around.
Right. At the writer,
but nobody was around who knew stand-up. I mean, I was the only one doing stand-up. Everybody else was. I learned my comedy from Mark Lynn Baker, Joe Grafazzi, from actors that I watched.
The lesson that I'm taking away from this is you reinvented stand-up because you didn't come out of the traditional mold. That your stand-up is different than most others because of the way you developed. And there was almost an entrepreneurial spirit to your creative development. For guys like me, there already existed a scene. So I said, well, what do you have to do to be accepted into this scene? Oh, be like everybody else. I'm going to be like him. Oh, I'll be like him. And so I turned into this generic, I'm fishing for a compliment here.
Yeah, I was trying to come up with one, and it was harder than coming up with an act.
Well, it just so happens, Lewis, that I wrote a compliment for you to give to me. Oh, so if you could just read this.
I will certainly will. But no, you've always been.
Thank you.
One of my favorite comedians.
Yes.
No, nobody writes. Nobody writes as, look, you can say this, but the truth is no one writes some of the, what makes me laugh is dark, Yeah, either stupid, profoundly stupid, or profoundly dark. And
and that's why you were a big fan of the minstrel shows growing up. This is, a lot of people don't know this about Lewis Black. His he actually changed his name. It's Lewis Blackface is actually what it, but they changed it at Ellis Island. But your grandfather was one of the leading minstrel show performers in Kiev. Lewis Blackface.
No, but you have a... You get a sense of there's a dark streak in your comedy that I really, you know, makes me fucking laugh.
Well, dark is the only thing that's funny.
Yeah, it is.
No, it isn't.
There's,
I think it's a certain breed.
There's those great Christian comics tickle my funny bone. Fuckers, you know.
I wish I could be a Christian comic.
Boy.
I wish I could be a Christian. It would make a lot easier.
We should have just gone into fucking that bracket.
Yelling. There are some cultures where yelling is acceptable. It's almost a sign of affection.
Well, fucking Jewland.
Jewland. Italian land.
Yes.
Irish, not so much.
Irish, not so much. It's weepy land.
It's weepy land. So we're a hot-blooded people. I have a friend who's 80 years old. He's my accountant. And
he... Does he know there's Quicken Books and stuff? Just the tip, maybe things. See, yeah, you can get a nicer sweater.
My kids, you know, I'd be on a speakerphone, and we'd be going over, and he'd be screaming at me. And my son would go, "What did you do?" I go, "Nothing. We're just going over the book." It's just a way of... So, yelling.
Yes.
I don't think you yell in real life. I think you found the funny in yelling around you. I don't think you're a screamer in real life.
No, I was as a kid. I mean,
oh, really?
I was, in the sense that the revelation to me of my comedy, you know, that thing of like you, a comic, the most difficult thing for a comic to do is take the person sitting at the table and move the 3 feet to the stage. Mm-hmm. And take the personality that's sitting in that seat and trundle that personality.
That's really important. Say that again, please.
So the difficulty for any comic, I think, is taking the personality that they have that makes them funny. Of who they are, the essence of their funny, and taking it from sitting around the table with the gang,
mm-hmm.
and getting up, and you walk onto the stage, and getting the 3 feet that you would, if you're sitting at that front table, to go from that front table where you're the funny, because everybody, well, I can do that, you know, right. I'm so fucking funny, and then you move that 3 feet, and all of a sudden you're not funny anymore.
Right.
Getting that personality from here to there is an extraordinary journey.
An extraordinary journey that doesn't require jokes or talent, but authenticity.
Right. Very good. That's true.
It's something I never understood.
Yeah.
So I just kept looking. I just got to find that right joke. And no, you just have to be yourself.
You have to be yourself. And it's difficult to be yourself because
I'm David Feldman.
And I'm Lewis Black.
And
not just because we're Jews, but I mean, for a lot of the people who work in stand-up, there's that getting over that kind of self-loathing or that touch of, and that lack of confidence. Because
right.
The changeover for me was when I started to go into clubs and watch before I really transitioned from playwright to stand-up, I would go into clubs and watch, and I'm going, are you shitting me? This schmuck has not said one fucking funny thing. I'm in panic about my fucking stuff that's funny, and I'm watching this guy. It's the Dale Carnegie School of Comedy. I am so confident mm-hmm. that what I'm saying is absolutely the funniest thing you've ever heard, that you will all laugh now.
Right.
Wow.
Right.
See, you know, and it's like, and then I started to notice, which is something that John and I and any kind of comic you do it, any comic that I trust does it, is just like, you're in a live room. So if something occurs, like you don't get three laughs in a row, you got to be fucking cognizant of it. You can't just kind of fly by as if, well, you know, look at my shoes. These are really special. You kind of have to, you know, notice that these people, they didn't even need to be in the fucking room.
Right.
And that was the big, where I kind of, but it, that is off what we were saying.
No, that's important.
But that was where I went, oh my God. The only thing that changed different, the only difference between me and them, really, in terms of presence, I'm bringing no self-confidence onto the stage. What the fuck's the matter with me?
You're not bringing self-confidence.
I'm not at all.
Right. You're still not.
You know?
You know, you're still not.
Right.
You're loud and angry, but you're losing it on stage. You're, yeah. You know, it's a controlled nervous breakdown.
It is.
And it's real.
Yeah.
You're not thrilled. To me, what's great about you, and I don't like complimenting other comedians, especially ones who have done a lot better than I have, but it's an inconvenience for you to be there. To me, that's the funniest thing in the world, is that it's a sold-out audience. People have paid money and hired babysitters, have been waiting to see you for 3 months. They have to pay for parking. They're all excited to see Lewis Black, and you rather be someplace else. And that's exactly what comedy is. Nobody should be happy to be performing comedy.
That's very funny.
That's
really true. It's something I'd never thought of.
There's something wrong with you if you're happy on stage.
But the yelling was, getting back to that whole thing of anger, is that that was when someone told me to start yelling. A comic who was a friend of John Bowman's, who was a big guy, Dan Ballard is his name, is big, 6'4", he's huge. He's a nicer looking version of the Hills with Eyes guys. He's got propecia, whatever that thing is. He's got no hair. And he would put little mini plungers on his head. Mm-hmm. He was fucking funny guy. Mm-hmm. But he would scream, and he would, in my club, it was at the West Bank, and he would scream at the audience. And he came off stage one night, and he said, it really was the life changer. He said, because I couldn't figure it out. And when I would yell, I was so, you know, not sure of that as a thing, that I would turn around and yell. I'd yell at the wall mm-hmm. behind me. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't yell directly in at the audience. And he came up and said, look, he said, I'm on stage yelling. And he said, really, there's nothing I should be yelling about. You know, but part of what made him funny was just the sense of, if you don't laugh at me, I'm going to beat the shit out of you. So there was a nice touch to that. But he said, there really is. There's nothing that I should be screaming about in here. You, he said, are really angry. You need to express.
So you really are angry.
There is a, well, in terms of what I was talking about.
Right. The cliche is that all comedy comes from anger.
Right.
I think great comedy, this is my theory, comes from fake anger, manufactured anger.
Well, it is in the sense you have to, I mean, one of the things I learned early on was is that when I yell, what I found when I was yelling that time, he said, I want you to go on stage and yell everything. So one thing I was doing was I was sitting on my anger, you know, and that's why I'm going, well, here's why I'm not fucking getting a laugh. Talk about creepy. Mm-hmm. Somebody who's like got a slow burn going, and it's going in no direction because he doesn't know how to get it. You know, he's building the tension without any release to it. And I realized as soon as I started yelling, I go, that's. Right. That's when people watch me get excited about nothing. Like I'd be sitting with my friends and go, you're not going to fucking believe this. So I'm down at the fucking this and da 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 da. And I go on and on and on. And it would build. And so when I started to hit the road, Kathleen said, I was kind of a year and a half into the gigs, or maybe two years. I was getting my sea legs finally. It was even earlier than that. And she was breaking in. And she said, you know you're on stage for 8 minutes yelling, and no one is laughing. I said, no cognizance of that. None.
Wow.
None at all. I thought they were, you know, that because I would hear them. Because
wow.
Also, I wasn't, the other thing is I used to talk, and silent, you know, silence to me was not even in the ballpark, you know. My fear was silence. You put a silence in and they're all, you know, sharks! The sharks are coming now! They can smell my blood! So I never had silence. I'd throw words in. I didn't give a shit. I would keep it moving until, and then.
But the theater training, when I go to a Broadway play, The laughs don't come at you the way a stand-up act.
Right.
So the hardest thing for a stand-up, a generic stand-up to do, is to not think about the laughs. You're always thinking about the laughs. How am I doing? How am I doing? How am I doing? And that stifles creativity.
Right.
You weren't worried about the laughs.
Yeah, I didn't even know. I was just thrilled I was getting a paycheck. Seriously, I mean, I wasn't, and then,
and you were concerned about what you were saying as opposed to what the audience was telling you.
Yeah, and also,
wow.
I thought they were getting it. I thought everybody was, you know, like, that I thought that the character was funny. It was inherently funny, this guy who, and then with Kathleen's input and some of the, I mean, and just, you know, you kind of go out every night, because that was the key to it. Of all the things, was being able to work 8 shows in a row, 45 minutes, because I had the material at that point. Right. I mean, I literally went, when I hit the road, I was a middle act for, I had maybe 8 gigs as a middle act, you know, because nobody wanted to follow me.
Mm-hmm.
So I ended up, once I kind of became the headliner and I had the time, I went, oh, see, if I start with the weather, if I'm psychotic about the weather, then A, it takes the onus off at the end when I'm psychotic about politics.
Right.
Because obviously, I have no sense of proportion.
Right, right.
That I'm just as livid about that piece of shit Al Roker as I am about that piece of shit Donald Trump.
And now you're in theaters.
Yeah.
And you're working stuff out in theaters.
Yeah.
You've done how many, 50 specials, 10, 12, 50? How many specials have you done?
Every night is special.
Oh, thank you.
I've done about 12 or something like
12
that.
12 specials?
Well, not on the George Carlin. I did a half hour stuff for
right,
Comedy
but that's
Central.
A lot of, that's a lot of material.
You know.
To come. That's a lot of material. You don't, as I.
And if it's not 12, just write me, tell me, I'll get the number right.
You don't do drop-in sets at the Cellar.
No.
You're out on the road. If you work your stuff out in front of crowds.
Yeah.
Does the crowd like to be in on the process? The God's honest truth is, no, I won't do it because I feel I'm. But if I pick up a piece of paper and read jokes to an audience, I kill. They love it. And I just can't do it because it looks unprofessional. But the biggest laughs I get are just trying jokes out in front of an audience.
Then do it.
Well, it's...
Yeah, why don't you flush your career down the toilet due to your stupid pride?
Well, it's
there
already...
There must be a song there.
It's already in the toilet. So
no, but I mean, yeah, they... Cause
the audience wants to help you develop your act, right?
Yes. And the audience... But the audience that seems to have shown up to see me knows... somewhere that I'm writing in front of them.
Mm-hmm.
And that, and they enjoy that. They enjoy, and this is not ego, it's just, it seems they, because I don't quite get it, they enjoy the way I think.
They
so they like watching me think.
When did you have the courage, or did you always have the courage, to write on stage in a theater and let things... Let the chips fall where they may, and a bit might not be ready, and it'll die, and not be panic stricken.
Well, that took a while, but from the moment I started working theaters, I was already there. From the moment, I mean, early on, but I mean, from the very beginning, I was doing it. I would be panic stricken, but I was doing it. I was literally doing it in front of people, and
because that's what the theater is.
Yeah.
That's what the theater is, taking chances. Theater is being in the moment.
Yeah.
And you're not competing with a lousy opening act and a a bartender, yeah, and ice and a waitress and a check drop. The theater is a perfect venue to develop an act.
It is. I mean, John, my opening act, doesn't. He does the same thing that I do. You know, he writes some notes and writes some things. There's certain things that he really does write down. You know, after we did Root of All Evil, he started writing more of his, but he's still, I'd say, 80% of it. I'm going on stage with 75% of my act that I know.
Right.
Now I'm going on stage with probably about, you know, I'm trying to drop as much as possible because I did a special, and now it's a matter of dropping it and getting it and making sure that
I can't believe what? This is I'm exploiting you and I feel terrible.
Yeah, really, you know, Dave. If I had a life, you know, I'm fine. I'm serious. I don't mind.
Three questions I want to get.
I am really, you know, and also because this is interesting to me. You want to talk about this stuff on occasion, and you never, okay, you know, there's no other places to talk about this. So,
but I have a lot of questions I want to ask you.
So ask them, fucker. Okay. So make it a three-part special, and and let's try to get some advertising. Because I finished the special before this election, now I've got to come up with this new. Every night, it has been, okay, I'm going to try this. Let's try this. And I walked on stage. I was in New Haven recently. And all I did was walk on stage and tell them I'd gone to Yale. And I told them my story of Yale. That was, and I said, and I'm telling you this to avoid the subject that you know that you came to hear me talk about. And I don't want to fucking talk about it.
Mm-hmm. And can you go up with just some brief notes in your head about what you want to talk about? Speak extemporaneously, fearlessly, that there may not be laughs, but know that if you're committed to what you're saying, it'll be compelling.
Yes. But, I mean, I'm still, I know, and I trust the fact that I'll get the laughs, that I'll know where to get the laughs.
There's, but you're not things, afraid of not getting a laugh.
No, I'm not afraid of that.
And to me, that's what makes great comedy. Letterman wasn't afraid of something not working.
Yeah. And what it does is make me think harder.
And it makes the audience think.
Yeah.
When the audience isn't laughing hysterically, they're deciding whether or not they like you or agree with you.
Right.
So you're more memorable. You can make an audience laugh every 10 seconds, and they leave, and they don't remember you. They don't even remember what they laughed at. But if you're making an audience think, then they do remember you.
One of the things that, going back to what we were talking about, just in terms of your thing, in terms of the process of them, what does the audience know? Why do they like that? You mm-hmm. holding up the paper. This is how smart the audience is, because I said to an audience, this is New Haven, Connecticut. This is Schubert Theater. It's not just Yale professors. It's the community at large. And I'm explaining my time at Yale and my time that I'd come out of Chapel Hill, and I'd had all of this playwriting background. And that in that entire time, I was never, ever, by anyone, taught plot. And I said that, and the audience burst into laughter, which was something I didn't expect, which meant they got it.
And what does that mean?
Well, that they're that far along, that they understand the importance of plot when they're watching something now. Mm-hmm. That they, I would say 30 years ago, if you talked about plot, people wouldn't. That they've watched so much, they've seen so much, they've read so much, that they have a sense now of what, you know, structures are.
Right.
You know, they may not know what it is or what a plot is precisely, but they know that it's important.
But plot is important. I suspect it's overrated. It's moments. That it's a series of moments.
But you still have to have something to string it on. And you have to at least have that in your head. I mean, I didn't even know. I mean, seriously, no, you know, that's like, it'd be like saying, okay, we're going to teach you math,
right?
But we're not going to be giving you any numbers.
Right.
So, good luck.
Right. That's an area that Well, you just worked with Woody Allen again.
Yeah.
But if you go back and look at his early work, or anybody's early work, it's just a string of jokes.
You're right. Yeah.
With a plot.
Right.
Just to.
Yeah. But the fact that the audience knew what a plot was meant to me that they're smarter than we. Mm-hmm. They're way, way down the road now.
My fantasy about your working with Woody Allen is you didn't have to audition. This is what I think people at your level get to experience. You don't know who's watching you. You put something out into the ether, and you have no idea where it's going. And you're constantly amazed by the number of times your heroes will walk up to you to talk about you. I know that you've experienced that.
Yeah.
And
shocking.
It's shocking. So before we get to Woody Allen, who blew you away? Where did you think, I can't believe this MF-er who I worship is talking to me about me instead of about him? Do you remember the first time that happened?
Well, I mean, David Kelly, who, you know, was kind of at the peak of his...
Mm-hmm. Picket Fences, Chicago.
Yeah,
Hope.
Yeah, and he was in...
Michelle Pfeiffer.
Boston Legal, yeah. But he stopped me at the... I was walking up the aisle. I was there at the Emmys, and he stopped me and said, you know, that he really thought I was... And I was like, you got to be kidding me. You know, there have been a few like him. You know who's the most overwhelming, just in terms of being in the presence of two people, but one in particular. When I ran the West Bank, and this was not didn't know me, but I I'm standing there, my back is to the. I would take tickets and then go on stage and talk. So they'd pay me at the door, and then I'd go on stage. And my back is to the room, and I turn around, and it was Julie Andrews.
Wow.
And Julie Andrews is not somebody that if you'd said to me, well, Julie Andrews is coming tonight, I'd go, yeah, well, somebody. I turn around, it was literally as if it was like she did nothing. It was just that sense of energy. Mm-hmm. There was an aura around her, an energy that was just stunning. Her daughter's play, I didn't think about it, her daughter's was directing a play there that night. I didn't think she'd show up. And I was, and I said to her daughter, I said, you know, do you think your mother's going to mind? You know, you know how I talk on stage. You think your mother's going to mind? She goes, nah, she'll love it. And then I came off afterwards, and Julie Andrews was, and this was when I had just doing 3 to 5 minutes, and she was like effusive. And you kind of go, wow.
Well, that's when you came up with this song, A Spoonful of Cyanide Makes the Medicine Go Down, I believe.
Yeah, and the big one was Carlin. It was right. George Carlin leaving me a message on my phone. He left a message on my phone when nobody knew who I was.
Do you still have it?
No. Well, I do, but I'd be hard pressed to. Do you have interns?
I am an intern. So what did he say?
He left a phone message saying that he had. It was a great message. I was living in a 5-floor walk up and was, you know, trundling down to do clubs, and I had just maybe it had one special. I had little things on. Maybe it had a special on Comedy Central, but nothing. I mean, seriously, just going back out doing the clubs and coming back to New York and doing clubs and doing all of that and playing the road. So I get home and it's hi, Lewis, is George Carlin. And first off, let me just say there is nothing I can do for your career. So let's start there.
Wow.
But I want you to know, he said, you know, I've seen your material and I've watched you and you really make me laugh. And if you have anything around, if you got something that, you know, any kind of material that, you know, that you wanted to send out to me and my friends, because we really love your work. And I was like, and that was the life change.
What do you mean, like jokes or actual stand-up?
No, doing me doing stand-up.
Right.
You know, if I had, you know, a CD or something.
Right. Yeah.
And
right.
I was overwhelmed. I didn't have a CD. I had nothing. And
that gets you through how many years of?
The next 5, easy. I mean, because at that point, what it did was made me realize if one of my heroes gets what I'm doing and thinks it's funny, then what else do I fucking need?
Right. There's nothing.
An elevator.
There's nothing I can do for your career.
Yeah, that's really great.
And there isn't anything he could do for your career, because there's nothing he could do to make you funny. Only you could just get up night after night and grind it out. There's nothing. The only thing I could do for your career, Lewis, is abuse you. The only thing I could do is be a voice in your head every day telling you you're worthless, you're never going to make it, you're a failure, you've let everybody down, you should be ashamed of yourself. Well, that's the most helpful thing I could do.
Well, that's going to be tough, because that means you don't have to wrestle my mother. who's sitting to the right hand of God.
But there is, to me, that is the difference between the ones who make it and the ones who don't. I think when we're all young, we think there is some magic formula. I kept waiting for somebody to explain it to me when I was in my 20s. I know that there's a piece of paper, and here's the path, and if I just follow this path, I'll get my degree in comedy.
Yeah.
And somebody will, there is no path. You make your own path.
Yeah, you make your own path.
When did you learn that? I never really
Well, I learned got partly that. Because of being in theater, so it wasn't a major transition to be in something that was also very similar to that. And but
you're not a follower. You're not a follower. I think I'm a follower. And I'm not, I think when I look back at my career, I chose the bourgeois options.
But I mean, what were the, you know, but if you were going to learn stand up, if that was your path, that would be where you'd go. You'd go to the clubs, you would do that. I was literally doing it on the side and didn't really have an interest in the clubs, and I was just kind of trying it out on my own.
There was a moment.
Then I'm going to lay waste to you.
No, I think my problem has always been I talk and interrupt and don't listen. So you go ahead. That's what I was going to say.
No, the weirdest thing to me, and which is part of what makes, I think, what the difficulty was, more so than maybe in even theater, was that what I fully didn't comprehend, and still don't to this day, how could it be easier to learn what is an extremely, you know, I think, you know, difficult craft. Kathleen never calls. Kathleen thinks it's bullshit.
But calling it a craft?
Yeah, she's really. Yeah, but she's nuts. So,
what does she think? It is an art?
No, she. No, God, no. She just thinks it's Hong Kong quack quack.
I wish she were here instead of you. You have no idea how much I wish Kathleen Madigan were here.
She'll come. But I just think it's weird that it's harder to learn stand up. How can it be easier to learn stand-up than the business of stand-up?
Right.
Stand-up is hard, but how can the business of stand-up be harder? And it is. So how the fuck is that possible?
Well, I mean, think about that. Because you can either be funny. Usually, there's a guy named Chris Kelly who I love. He's a great comedy writer. Works for Bill Maher, and he's the funny. He's the best. There are a couple of guys. He's one of the guys who taught me how to write jokes, and just by watching him. And I said to him, "God gave you funny," when he was complaining about his whatever some series that he came up with didn't. I said, "He gave you funny. He didn't give you 100 episodes of this sitcom. What would you rather have?" And I think he said 100 episodes of this sitcom, but I don't think. It's very hard to have both, to have a business sense and a comedic sense, right? Yeah,
there's a few that got it. I mean, John Stewart has it.
Yeah.
I think Carell has it. Mm-hmm. Colbert has it. I mean, all the other guys who came out of that have it. I never have.
Well, you are a control. I mean, you are a disciplined lunatic. I mean, you did go. Didn't you? You were a good student, right?
Yeah.
You graduated magna cum very loud.
Yeah, I graduated.
That's a joke. Bad joke.
I ignored it completely.
I know. Thank you.
Just so our friendship would remain intact.
I know. And the thing that is happening to me is it's almost like being a 2-year-old smearing his own stuff. It's the one problem with this podcast is when I go, I make a bad joke, and then it's just, I swim in it. when you were in high school in Maryland, you applied to Princeton.
Yeah.
You applied to Williams.
Yeah.
You applied to Amherst.
Yeah.
You applied to Harvard.
No, not Harvard. Yale.
Yale. And you got rejected.
And Brown.
And Brown.
I just discovered my mother's throwing the... throwing stuff out, and they're in thing, and then there's one of the woman who's kind of the one of the caregivers is collecting the stuff and sending it to me. I have if I'd known you were going to bring it up, I could have brought all 5 copies. My mother kept the rejections.
And what did the admissions officers know about you that your audiences don't? What did they see in you by rejecting? But you ended up.
I ended up in Maryland for a year, and then...
what did you want to do? What did you think? Because your life would have been different.
What did I want to do? I wanted... I didn't know until the end of that year that I wanted to... that there had to be a theater on the campus. That I knew.
Till you got to college.
Yeah, I mean, but just, you know, I had applied already to these schools, and really... Williams might have been good for Brown. Certainly would have been great.
Right.
Yale really not so much. I wanted a theater program, and I realized that by the time that I'd been, you know, fucked over. So
in high school, though,
yeah,
because I do believe high school is life.
Right. It is. No, it's the real world is just like high school. Only there's more places to eat. One of my favorite jokes. One of my early favorite jokes. I bring it out every so often on stage because it's true.
Every dream I had was in high school.
Yeah.
What I wanted to be. And I keep using high school as the yardstick to see if my dreams have come true.
Right.
What did you want to do in high school?
Stay there.
No, really?
Yeah. I had a really good...
Nobody has a happy high school experience.
Yeah, we did.
Really?
Well, yeah, kind of. I mean, you know, outside of the kind of relationship stuff, it was great. Because we had a different kind of high school. We had... We entered high school together in the 7th grade, about 300 of us, and then... or more, and we were together for 6 years.
Isn't that suffocating?
Well, it turned out to be 5. By the end, there was 512 by the time we were in the 9th grade.
That's a lot of sex you guys were having.
Boy, yeah, we were spawning like bunnies. But, you know, there were 512. And, so it wasn't, because it was such a large class. So that we actually, I mean, what was weird was it really did, over time, there was no animosity because you knew everybody. So it wasn't a case of, like, those are the this or those are the this group or that group or the other group. All the groups had their groups, and it was great, great. That's your group. I got my group, you know.
What was your group?
My group was somewhere between really extremely funny, bright, and people and those of us who kind of, you know, ran the student government and stuff like that.
So even back then you were into politics.
Yeah, well, no, because I couldn't get elected. But this is what I did do. Which is, to me, the proudest moment of my life, which is probably why I didn't end up in politics. So I was a senior And so I was going to be gone. And all of the, everyone running for office was, wanted me to, my brother was running, for unopposed to be the president of the school, and the, or in the others.
Did you have a school government or a Politburo?
We had a Politburo.
Unopposed.
We had a student government, and they. But those running for the three other posts, they all came to me on both sides and said, "Will you write our speech?"
Wow.
And I said, "But I'm writing the other guy's speech." And they went, "I don't care."
Wow.
So I was writing. If I wasn't writing the speeches for each candidate, I was writing the campaign manager speeches, because the one thing that I did know was how to write kind of funny.
So you wrote speeches for the candidates
running against each other.
You are like Dick Morris.
Yeah. You know, because I knew I could make them entertaining, and what did you want to say? And okay, and I'll get that.
I've never heard of this before. That's amazing.
It was pretty interesting.
Isn't that unethical? I mean, you're like Kellyanne Conway.
Yeah.
You really are.
Yeah, but it's not unethical, because both sides knew the other side. It wasn't like I was cheating a side. They knew that I was.
So it was writing and politics. You're good at math. Your father is an engineer.
Yeah. Yeah, but I never knew. I was good at it, but I never fucking understood. I still don't know what it's for, except that.
But you grew up where math came easily to you because your parents.
Yeah.
You grew up in a house filled with numbers.
Right.
My theory about you is, your father is an artist.
Yeah, he became an artist. Yeah.
Painter. This is my theory about Lewis Black. You grew up where your father wanted to be an artist. And this is very similar to me.
Mm-hmm.
Your father wanted to be a full-time artist, but because he had to support a family, he worked as an engineer. Right. But on the weekends, you would come downstairs and there would be a circle of men standing around a nude woman. And there were no easels. That's how I grew up. There'd be no, because my father couldn't afford easels or paint. But there was a circle, and he'd go, "David, go upstairs. Just go back upstairs." And
yeah, my father ended up. And I think this really made it easier for me, was that my father, at the age of 55, said, "I've had enough of this," and retired, and went on to do art. I mean, we're talking, this is the late 60s.
Wow.
So he. He said, I want to do, he left, he was a mechanical engineer making sea mines. He read.
Sea mines.
Yeah, which is those little, the things with the, you know, that you put in your harbor to protect your harbor from submarines.
Oh, stuff. Right.
And he was a designer of those. And they're supposed to be a defensive weapon. So he never really he wanted out of that business. You're not going to get out of that business. When he tried to get out of this business, he was trying to do it at a time when they weren't hiring Jews. So he, and he didn't have a last name. His last name was Black. So he would go to the interview and then, you know, and then it would come out that he was Jewish. And then so he was stuck in government. He made these things. And then we entered the Vietnam War, and he, my mother decided it was morally, you know, it was immoral. And my father said, "Well, it's based on the scope of Tonkin Resolution." He sat down and read the Geneva Accords. Who the fuck does that?
Mm-hmm.
And I do, I mean, I will remember until the day I die, my father sitting there with a little.
Really?
Book. Yeah. With a little blue, if you saw the book, you'd know exactly, because you used to go to libraries too, where the little reference books mm-hmm. might be in this kind of little blue thing. And so with a hardback, and it's like 80 pages, and he read the whole fucking Geneva Accords. And he reads the Geneva Accords, which is what the Gulf of Tonkin Resolution is based on, and basically finishes it and says, there is no basis at all for us to be in Vietnam. And so we mine Haiphong Harbor. And my father goes, and so now his weapons are being used as an offensive weapon.
Wow.
In a war that he finds immoral, and he quits.
Wow.
And retires.
Wow.
Which is really an extraordinary.
Wow.
It's an extraordinary, I still think to this day, one of the most extraordinary things I've ever witnessed in my life. Nobody
Why isn't he here instead of you?
If I'd known, I certainly would have sent him.
Okay, so
but he requires...
64, Gulf of Tonkin was attacked. Johnson kind of lied about it.
Right.
But he used it as the excuse to send 500,000 troops into South Vietnam.
Right.
All wars based on a lie.
Right.
The mining of Haiphong Harbor, I believe, happened under Kissinger.
Right.
So it took about 5 years for him to realize, because they weren't mining the harbors in Vietnam until
right.
Nixon and Kissinger
right.
started doing it.
And then he was done. And when they did that, because he could basically, if we were going to mine the harbors of Saigon, fine, but he was not, you know, but that was it. And then he walked away and became an apprentice to a guy who did stained glass and did stained glass and then started painting. And so I think that, and then the fact that he had, you know, that I'd seen in the basement stuff, you know, paintings that he had kind of done, you know, mm-hmm. his watercolors and things, and that he'd quit doing it, and then he went back to doing what he wanted to do. And I thought, fuck, then you should really do what you want to do.
That informs everything about you. That tells me who you are, why you are, and the faith that you have in creativity. At the Writers Guild, when John Waters was talking about writing,
yeah.
and the way he described writing,
mm-hmm.
it was this idealized version of being a writer. You know, it's the greatest job in the world. You wake up, you go to your computer, and you spend time with your ideas, and then in the afternoon, you sell it. You try yes, to sell yeah. it. And that's how he described it. And I thought, wow, what a great life. I've never lived that.
Yeah, neither have I.
But you have. You have lived a... You have answered to yourself. You, I'm a follower. I always came up to the brink, and then I'll take this job. That's always been, for whatever reasons, this isn't about me. But you've stayed true to the way you were raised. I think it has something to do with your parents. I think you have to answer to your parents.
Yeah.
And they would not approve of...
My mother would have approved. My mother would have been thrilled for me to be doing something else. My mother said early on, when I was going to Yale for drama, she said... why don't you go for health administration? Because seriously, this is like 1974. That's where the money's going to be. And my mother's not like a money person.
She's a teacher.
What
does she teach?
She taught
compromise.
Yeah, she taught. She taught whoredom. But that was the way she saw it.
What did she teach?
She taught math. That was basically, but that was when she taught. But then she became a substitute teacher and taught anything. Put her in any classroom, she'd teach whatever you got to teach.
So you did grow up with math.
Yeah, I mean, but she was really a biology, zoology major. She went to Hunter College.
Great.
You know, yeah.
Right. Wow.
You know, she was brilliant. I mean, she graduated Hunter when she was like 15. She graduated college, so I mean.
So you grew up, there was an intellectual tradition in the house.
Yeah, there was I mean, my father read, you know, my father gave me Catch 20. My father read Catch 22. He was reading Catch 22. He was laughing. And I said, and I was 13. I said, you like that book? He said, yeah. He said, yeah. And I said, should I read it? He said, yeah. Oh, yeah, you should read it. It'll tell you everything you need to know about working in an office.
And are you prone to read fiction or nonfiction when you have time?
I go back and forth. Now I'm reading fiction. I never read The Confederacy of Dunces, so I'm reading that now.
I just watched a documentary about Warren Buffett. It was on HBO, and I'm sure they've left out the... I'm sure when all is said and done about Warren Buffett, there'll be something that comes out that... But right now, he's our generation's Lincoln.
Right, yeah.
You know, there has to be something screwy about some guy... living in Omaha, Nebraska, making billions of dollars. It just doesn't make any sense. It just doesn't. But I'll believe the legend as opposed to the lie. They show him going to work, and he gets up every morning, goes to his office, and he reads for 6 hours a day. He says, part of my job is to sit with the newspapers, sit with the magazines, and read 6 hours a day.
Wow.
A couple of people I know. I know Ralph Nader. He considers part of his work day sitting with the Wall Street Journal, the New York Times, and the Washington Post, that he doesn't feel he's done his job. And I saw a documentary about you on the road, and you're in your bus reading.
Yeah.
Do you consider that part of the job? Are you willing to carve out? Because I struggle with this.
I don't carve out as much time as I believe I should. You know? But I try to, you know, I get up, I turn on that CNN, it's like good for seven, and then front page of the Times, I go through, I read the Post, you go through the Post.
Washington or New York?
New York. It's the yin and the yang, you know, the New York Post, the paper that I said is the only paper with the guts to print its own news. I said, really? I go, you know, and I've said this for years. I go, you read the Post. You go, God, this hasn't happened. And 2 weeks later, it does. So I kind of go through that. I read, you know, some sections of that. I read some sections of the Times. I generally stand. I find more and more that I go to the editorial page because they actually do the research.
Mm-hmm.
So, and I find more information. I find where to go from there rather than the... Usually there's nothing on the front that fucking... You know, it's like, really, you're not going
right.
to... You go to the back and Gail Collins or Christoph or somebody's got... oh, really? Okay, I'll check that out. So
I always tell my listeners and my kids, and I don't conflate the two, that read the editorial page of the New York Times because, except for Trump, that's what the president reads every morning.
Yeah.
If you want to know what Obama is thinking and is informing his decisions, read the editorial page.
Yeah, no, that's the really... And then there's a thing called The Week, mm-hmm. which is, you know, for people like myself who don't stay up, I don't sit with the phone as much as everybody does, so I don't... I do that. So The Week is a really good collator of a variety of... What's nice about The Week is it... I prefer looking at... things that where a resume might be necessary. That's why I like newspapers. Mm-hmm. Somebody sat in an office, somebody looked at a resume, somebody said, oh, you went to a school to learn how to do this.
Speak to me about that, because now anybody can be a journalist, and now anybody can be a comedian. Now anybody can be a video maker. Now anybody can be a star. The democratization of everything is ruining our democracy.
Well, it's you know, I mean, the thing was is that I thought for a long time that the decentralization of art, you know, from like New York, Chicago, from New York and Los Angeles, where it was decentralized, which it had come in theater in terms of, there's, you know, the Steppenwolf in Chicago and Seattle has two major theaters, and Boston's got two major, you know, there's that decentralization. Minneapolis is Guthrie. But the decentralization in terms of television film, I thought would be a good thing. And it in the long run, I think it will be. In the short run, this is just... Because it's all an adjustment to... We are moving in I believe that we're moving from whenever you and I were born and raised, whatever what you want to call that, the end of the industrial age. And now we're in a technological age. And we've just entered. We're really, literally, I don't even think we've entered it. I think we're between ages. And mm-hmm. I think that's what makes it difficult, that we are literally, that doesn't help. I think that's part of all of what's going on, that we are at sea.
Right.
That we don't know what any of this means, that we gave ourselves a computer before we knew what that meant. We gave ourselves essentially an extra central nervous system without any comprehension of what it was going to be. We gave ourselves a phone that had 16,000 ways to get to Sunday on it. And all of this stuff is in it. They're all, everybody said, well, boy, you're going to do LSD. Jesus Christ, you're crazy. And meanwhile, we dropped this shit in our systems as if it was nothing, and it's bigger than LSD.
You're talking about the internet.
The internet, and
it's making me. This is what I'm struggling with right now, and we talked about this on last Friday's show. I try to do a digital detox. I try to do one, and I try to do a ritual now where I get up, have coffee, and think, and don't go to my phone.
Well, if you could think. You know, there's the stumper there. Really touching yourself is not thinking, okay? Imagining women is just not... I know you think it's thought.
Bobby Slayton said, Feldman, you're so pussy whip when you're masturbating, you imagine your wife.
Bobby
Slayton. But so with the digital detox, I find today I knew you were coming in, and not to embarrass you, but this is a big thing for me. Mm-hmm. It really is, because this could lead to Kathleen Madigan.
Yeah, I know, exactly.
So I'm like, right. And I really prepped for this, and I wanted to stay off my phone. I wanted to think and just write, and I couldn't do it. I just kept, so how do you, what is your discipline with the phone and the internet?
Well, one of the things is that I don't have a lot of, I don't know, you know, you're on my Twitter feed, okay?
I'm so, sorry to hear that.
No, but I have these people on my, I don't know how these people arrived on my Twitter feed.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know where they came from. I don't understand it. I don't know how, I'm serious. I know how you did. I know how CBS Morning did. I know how the things that I, Kathleen, I get that. But there's all of these people, you know, Geppetto's nursery. Well, I don't give a shit about Geppetto and his fucking nursery. So I look at it a little, but I don't pay much attention to it. And my Facebook page, I could give a fuck about. I mean, I will check certain things just in terms of blowback from time to time.
Right.
And also to see that certain things you're getting, because certain things you're getting out there that I think should be getting out there. But mostly, so I don't look at my, I have a personal Facebook feed, which was, I have a personal page and a professional page. The personal page was developed so that people, as I wandered around the country that I might know,
right,
would get in touch. Well, nobody fucking has ever gotten in touch because of a Facebook page, ever. Except for people you never wanted to see again. They get, they're like, I'm you like, fucking, oh boy, uh-huh, you're coming to town. Could my cousin and Shelley and three others, you know, they're calling for people that I don't even fucking know. So none of that intrigues me. So that takes a ton of that off there. I don't know how to find things.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it was like, I didn't know Breitbart existed. That's where I was at. Steve Bannon, he's in charge of Breitbart. I wasn't like, I'm sitting there, what the fuck is Breitbart?
These things...
And that makes you feel like an idiot, but well, why would you fucking, why should I give a shit?
Right, and you know, this thing about the resume, that's really interesting to me, because a resume, and I think it is a thing of the past, that's our generation, you hold up a piece of paper, okay, let's see whose ass you kissed for the past 20 years. Let's see how good an ass kisser you are.
Yeah.
And the generation coming up is like, F that, I work for myself. I have all the tools, I don't need to have a boss. And there are two things I wanted to ask you. One is, do you ever wish, like when I was at the Daily Show briefly, I used to see you, do you ever wish you were in with the writers? Do you feel you're missing out? You were at the Writers Guild. Do you think, because as a stand-up, I crave the writers' room.
Yeah.
And that's why I kind of walked away from the stand-up. Well, the audience walked away.
No, stop. No, you were terrific.
But I kind of, yeah. I thought, well, this is interesting because you,
I thought you should have worked with puppets, but you were really, really
well,
good.
I turned out to Smigel. That dog is amazing. Dog is funny.
That dog is funny. That dog kills me.
That, what drove me crazy this summer is I know reporters and political satirists who would have given anything to get the access that dog was able to get, because it's just a puppet. And I go, are you kidding? kidding me? Gary Johnson, the libertarian candidate, is going to hang out with us? Loves the puppet.
Loves,
you know,
the puppet. Yeah, well, of course.
It's like a beautiful woman,
yeah,
can gain access to the highest corridors, yeah, of power, and I can get a PhD in business, and I can't, yeah, meet with Jesse Elmet, the head of GE, but a beautiful woman, yeah, can.
But maybe if you carried a crucifix on your back.
So I am turned on by, you know, the table and the guys and gals sitting around.
It drove me nuts.
Yeah, and it drives me nuts, too. But yet, I do find some virtue to that. Do you ever wonder what's going on in that room, if there's something? No.
No, I know what's going on in that room. Madness.
Madness, yeah.
When we were doing Root of All Evil, I finally blew up and said, I'm not coming back in this room again. You people are insane.
Mm-hmm.
Because they were parsing over,
right, you know. And living vicariously.
Yeah. And this is funny. Plus, they were dealing with, Patton is funny, Greg Giraldo is funny, Kathleen is funny, you know. If they say they're going to do this, there's no reason, we don't need to go through a rewrite of this stuff. Come on, guys.
But I need to justify my paycheck.
Yeah, but fuck it. I'm saying, go ahead and go down to the board, start working on the next show.
But if I do that, then I can't say that I had anything to do with the show.
It's fine that you did. You already did it, you know. It drove me the fuck.
But it's making me feel less than. I want to be part of this.
Well, you know, I'll bring in a fucking life counselor.
Well, I need to go home and watch a show with my family and point to a joke and say, I wrote that. Just what about my needs? What about my needs?
Fuck you and your needs. Lie to them.
But then I'm going to feel like a fraud.
Nobody feels like a fraud. And I never understood it. I just never got, and we were in with really good people. I never got it.
I, at the Writers Guild.
And I could do it with, there's two people, I mean, you know, I've done it with two or three, Stilson,
mm-hmm,
Jeff Stilson, I've worked with him. And I've worked, where we worked on, where it was, we were doing this thing for a special, I mean, a pilot for Comedy Central called Red State Diaries. So, uh-huh, you know, with the two of us, and he would feed me lines or feed me through lines. You know, we worked together well, Kathleen and John and I. What ended up happening is Kathleen, I just said, I will be in the room with them,
mm-hmm,
and we'll work on it in there.
At the Writers Guild Awards, I looked around the room. It was a very sweet night, and I'm very proud of the union, and I looked around the room and I saw a lot of very talented writers for television and movies, but the television writers in particular, they have a look on their face that says, I've compromised. And they're only worth hiring is if they have that look on their face that says, I've compromised.
Is that right? That's
funny. I think the guys who say,
wow,
who come into it going, this is fantastic. I'm going to have an idea, and then I'm going to be a team player and have it completely rewritten and gone through a meat grinder. This is fantastic. I can't imagine a funny person coming into a situation, I'm going to compete with people who are just as funny, or God forbid, funnier than I am and smarter than I am, and be happy about it. Sign. That sounds great. That, you know, it's madness. There's a madness.
Well, there's a madness to the 12, 15. I mean, I do the thing now with the Daily Show where there's three of us. I mean, they're two write it, and then I get a, and then they send it to me, and then I come in, and then we work on it. And that's really, it's the first time I've started to do that in a long time.
Well, I think two people writing together is as good as sex.
Yeah, it is. That's really, I mean, it is.
And then you add the third person, and suddenly somebody's being left out.
Yeah, but that's fine, because I'm the performer, so that really doesn't, I really have a, one thing is I have a tremendous respect for people who write. So, I mean, since I do it, then I kind of respect the, mm-hmm, what they, I respect, not that I, but I respect what it is they do. So I listen to them because they're the ones who've been thinking about it. I have not been using the whole day to think about my shit. And they have. So I think they're, it's always, It's really when it's right. I was going to say the Bill Sheft, mm-hmm. the thing about you, because I asked the Sheft, I said, geez, what did you think of the writer's room? He said, I never went in a writer's room. Mm-hmm. He said, my whole thing was, is I'm going to be in here and I'm going to write jokes. He said, I didn't get into this to write jokes with people. I mm-hmm. got into it so I could sit around and write my stuff. And I thought, well, you know, that's really, and that's what I've always thought. Or friends of mine who've written, like the Days and Nights of Molly Dodd, I think was written. You know that you know the whole idea is that you don't go into the writer's room. You write the script. Then you meet with the producer, the two co you know execs on the thing, and then they give you the notes, and you go back and finish writing it. I mean, it's a little easy.
The only way to serve up Gary Belkin, who wrote for your show of shows, and he mentored me for a little while. Because he saw me at the improv and gave mm-hmm. me, he thought I was funny. When I became a writer, he said, you're too old. I was 35 when I started as a writer. And he said, you're too old. So ever since I've been a writer, I've been convinced that ageism is hanging over me. But he said, I called him. I said, you know, I'm not having a good time. I'm not getting stuff into the script. I think they're going to fire me. Other guys are better than I am. I'm just not good at this. And he said it was the best advice anybody ever gave me back.
What was the show?
I'd rather not say.
Okay.
It was Roseanne. And I, through no fault of anybody's other than myself, I got fired.
Well, I could have hooked you up. I knew John Goodman.
Yeah.
It was, you know.
Well.
It's too bad.
And he said to me,
like I could help.
I know.
That would have been funny. It's send me $10,000. I'll talk to Goodman. I do know John, but he would have given it a shit.
Did he go to Yale Drama School?
No,
Steppenwolf.
I think Steppenwolf.
Yeah.
Or Steppenfetcher. Thank you. And we harken back to that other joke. Yeah, it took all day, but we got it.
He said to me, you've been invited to a party. You're at a cocktail party. It's a 12-hour cocktail party. The only way you're going to succeed is if you enjoy the company of the other comedy writers. If you're not going to enjoy the company of the other comedy writers, get out of business, go back to stand-up. This isn't about self-expression. This isn't about getting stuff into the show. It is about sitting around a table with a bunch of people whose company you enjoy. And once he told me that, it took me a while to implement that, but that's all it is. That's all comedy writing is. It's really being around people you respect, or yeah. learning to respect people you don't respect. There have been times when I've been sitting in a room with, I go, how do I respect this person? Because this person is a moron. And that struggle to respect another human being is why our standards have progressively gone down in this country. We've been forced to respect people who don't deserve respect for survival.
Yeah.
And we're getting progressively dumber and dumber.
That's very true.
Before you, hey, this was just, this was a gift to me.
This really was great. I really enjoyed it.
This was you and
God, if I just wish there was somebody else sitting across from me, but it was one of the.
I'm thinking we're like on the same page.
Exactly.
I was just thinking it's interesting about that to me is the compliment when you say that.
Yes, exactly.
That's when I feel the most affection from you is when you're crapping on me.
Exactly.
Finally, I'm going to say one thing. The F word. It has been estimated that in a special that you did, you used the F word 78 times.
I think that's lowball.
I have a problem with the F word. Do you? I have a theory about the F
word. You have a psychiatrist.
I think.
You can talk to them.
Do you think the F word is, my theory is you don't like the F word. I don't think anybody likes the F word.
Oh, I do. I do. And I also think I say it as well as anyone has ever said it. I think that's part of the reason I like it. Uh-huh. I don't think anybody says fuck as well as I do. I'm serious. There's got to be something to it because literally, I am approached. I mean, it's unbelievable how many people who will approach me and say, "Will you tell me to go fuck myself?"
Did you grow up hearing that?
My mother, I believe, was the first time I heard it.
Yeah, mine too.
Yeah. So I did hear it. And then it just became a...
That's interesting.
But then... And part of it was is that... And part of, I think, where I rebelled about it was is that I think that Jack Rollins took me in for a little bit, and he told me to drop it a little. Uh-huh. But he was less about that. And then there was... and Bud Friedman.
Right.
Who's in, you know, he said, you know, you shouldn't use that, you know, and it was like, and I gave it a shot, and it was like, it's not a word to me. It's like when I, you know, when I said that, you know, it's a comma.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not a word. It's, you know.
Are there, so growing up, were there things that your parents, like when you were in adolescence, did they protect you from saying certain things? Did they have things that they thought was inappropriate? What was the language growing up?
It was fine. Anything. It was not. I didn't ever felt any. You knew. You know, it was just that thing. This is common sense. You can, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, because my mother was like, you know, especially by the time the Vietnam War started, my mother was like just wandering, you know, the Cronkite would come on and literally she'd start screaming.
Right. That's how my mother is with Trump. I mean,
it's a half hour.
I say to my mother, you know, I still have some time left on this planet. I don't want the Secret Service coming for me. You know, knock it off. This thing he says that Woody Allen.
Yeah.
You met him.
Yeah.
Does it? And he's familiar with your work.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. No, I mean, I met him, you know, I mean, the one who really did it was Juliet Taylor. And Juliet is his casting person. And Juliet came in. If you watch Hannah and Her Sisters, what's truly extraordinary is coming out is... I come out of the scene. Juliet came to the West Bank and said, you're going to be in a Woody Allen movie someday. I said, well, great. She told Rusty McGee, who was also working there, you're going to be. So we get cast in this thing. And that's it. You show up at the set. So the scene that I'm in, the first scene I'm in is I walk out of the elevator with Christian Clemens, who is a Clemens, I think that's how you pronounce it. I think that's his name. I mean, it's really close. But he was in Ally McBeal. Well-known actor. You've seen him in a bunch of stuff. Julie Louis-Dreyfus is in that. Julie Kavner's in that.
Wow.
Julie Louis-Dreyfus, I think it was her first movie. I know it was Christian's. It's my first movie. Going down the hallway, John Turturro is there.
Wow.
His first movie. J.T. Walsh, his first movie that I know of. Rusty McGee in the chair. So it was literally bam, 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 bam. It was just an extraordinary. And they're all... And of them, I knew... Half I knew JT and John because of my theater shit, and so I knew a bunch of them, and it was like, this is unbelievable. Here's a great story though. So I'm out on the road, and I'm going to stay on the road, and they say Woody Allen wants to see you. He wants to meet with you.
Jesus,
There's a movie. And what's nice is every so often they would call. They would call before that. It was Woody's going to be doing a movie with Larry David, and they're really interested in you.
Mm-hmm.
And then it would go away. And this is where I've always had a theory about agents, is that just make shit up. I don't know if that's true. Who cares? They fucking can get me through 3 weeks. So they would tell me that, and then I could tell my friends, mm-hmm. You know, that there's been an interest that they may do it. It depends on. And then it would be they've decided to go older or younger. So I go. So it's Woody and Allen. And I kind of go, well, he put me in hand. And if there's anybody I'd go back to, 'cause I liked working with him. And he taught me everything I needed to know about, really, I mean, that I needed to know as an actor, performer, about being in a film. And because when we did the first scene with him.
This is Hannah and your sister.
Hannah and your sister. Yeah. When we did that first scene, he turns Christian and I had never done a movie. He goes, what we're going to do now is, he said, we're going to do a blocking rehearsal. We're just going to block this down, and then we're going to... So we do it, and then he says, okay, now what we're going to do is we're going to run it and see if it works. He said, okay, good. He said, we need to just do some camera adjustments, and then we're going to... Then after that, we're going to shoot. And we did it again. And he said, okay, good, we got it. Let's move on. So he said, so I want you to realize every time you're on film, it's a rehearsal. So,
hang on for 1 second. He filmed you rehearsing.
Yeah. So that we weren't acting.
And then he said to you, I want you to realize that that it's always a rehearsal.
It's always a rehearsal.
Because?
It's don't act. Don't start acting. Mm-hmm. Just say the words. You know what I mean?
Just say the words.
Because that's what we were doing, you know, and it works. Right. I mean, it's great. You know, it's like... You don't think about it. More than that, don't think about it.
And when you, this past year...
We hired you because you're you.
Right.
And and so then when I got this call, I went, I'll go back, because he really is somebody. And I spent some really interesting time on that set.
Is he the guy for you? Who is he? For me, he's the guy.
He's one of the guys.
Who's the guy? Shakespeare?
Yep. No, that's a Chekhov, and not as funny though.
Well, Chekhov was funny.
He's good. But it's I mean, there's a number of them. There's Woody is part of it, and Nichols and May is another big, and I think Newhart. I mean, it's weird.
So when you're, I'm gonna wrap it up. But last question.
And I'm 1,000 Clowns. Probably
that's just on. Gardner.
That probably shaped me as much as anything.
It was on Turner Classic Movies.
It's a great.
Jason Robards.
Yeah, he's wonderful.
The opening scene. If you want to know what New York looked like in the early '60s, 1,000 Clowns. It's about a. He refuses to grow up. The kid, I forgot his name.
Yeah,
is amazing. Yeah. Martin Balsam. I was just on Turner Classic.
It's a stunning little movie. I mean, it was also the whole thing. It really did shape the way I saw about authority and dealing with what's right and what's wrong. So I fly back to. I go, okay, fuck. I'm gonna have to do this. So I fly back to meet with Woody. And we go there, and he says, you just read the script. It doesn't matter. I'm in a room with three of them. It's him and the two other producers.
Now, this is the Amazon
script? No, this is something else entirely. This is another thing that's being done. I don't even know which movie it was, actually, in retrospect. And I'm reading, and I said, just read the script. It doesn't matter. I know you can do this. I'm not going to. Don't worry about doing anything, okay? I just need to take a look at you to see... If I can cast you opposite this actress, you may be too young.
That's nice to hear.
Well, it was spectacular. I said to him. So we finish up. He goes, I'll be in touch. I said, it doesn't matter. I said, you understand this? I won. I said, here's the deal. Either I get it because I'm good, or I don't get it because I'm too young. So this was a perfect audition.
Mm-hmm.
And then we did the Amazon, and the Amazon was just, they called, and then I was married to Becky Ann Baker, who's on Girls, plays the mother of Lena Dunham, who's I've known for 30 years. So, right. And Dylan Baker's is her husband. And so it was great. So we got to be husband and wife in the midst of a crumbling marriage.
And are you intimidated around Woody? Or are you?
No.
Who intimidates you?
Certainly not you.
Thank you. Who intimidates you? Who would you be around where you would go?
If cartoon characters came to life, Foghorn Leghorn.
I think... isn't Jeff Sessions?
I don't know. I mean, I'm kind of old. I'm over that point. I used to be intimidated by
Robin was pretty intimidating. Just the sheer power and intelligence.
But didn't he never? We got along, so it, I mean, I didn't feel intimidated by him. I felt in.
Do you think if somebody has a good bullshit detector, they're intimidating? I do. I mean, the I always found it intimidating to be around truly funny people when I was starting out, because I always thought the really funny guys had bullshit detectors and they would see right through me. So I it made me very shy.
I was always it was like it not so much intimidated, but didn't really push, like around Jon Stewart. I really should have pushed for stuff that I didn't push for. Just, okay, fuck it. A lot of it had to do with I have other shit to do, and I'm not going to get involved in the politics of this office. So at certain times that. I think that Letterman, yes. I never pursued spending time on the Letterman show as much as I like. And I probably could have done more on the Letterman show if I kind of had pushed for it. But
but he's intimidating.
Because Bill really liked me, Sheft, and and probably could have gotten me on. And but he's really, I found him intimidating.
Yeah. In terms of just.
But I have respect. A lot of more of it is respect. Like when I'm on with Colbert, I have a tremendous amount of respect for him. I have a tremendous amount of respect for John Oliver. I got to, you know, there are people that I've gotten to work with that I just go, wow.
Yeah, I think Letterman. There's a mystique to Letterman to this day that I'm sure millennials don't understand.
Yeah.
But I think Letterman would be very intimidating to hang out with just because, maybe because he's so mysterious. That maybe if you got to hang out with him for a day, you'd go.
The first time I did the show, it was like. At sea, and the second time I did it, I really felt like I worked well with him. But it was like, but it also, it's just those shows. It's like, we're going to interview you, and then here's the,
right.
I ask you this, and then you memorize that, and then, you know, it's all about.
Are you good, I swear to God, this is the last question.
Yeah.
I swear to you, this is the last question.
Yeah.
Are you good?
At everything.
Yes. Are you good at isolating what you should be doing? The sense I get with you is you don't waste time doing things that don't need to be done, that you focus on what's important, except for doing this show. But
this was a mistake.
This was a mistake. But are you good at prioritizing your day?
No. Jesus, who the fuck do you think I am? I'm not even good at getting the space on my desk. So no, I'm not good at it. What I am good at.
You cannot turn out as many specials as you do, and write as much as you do if you're not staying focused on the big picture.
Well, I am kind of. I stay focused on doing that because that's the through line of the year. Is always I'll be back on the road. We'll be back on the road shortly in Atlantic City. You're going to want to come on out to the beautiful Borgata. so I kind of do stay focused on it, but I do. I think it's really important that for me that one of the things, the real operating thing for me is it's got to be fun. If we're going to, why am I here? Because any of this would be fun.
Right. I'm sorry.
You live and you learn. you can't go back. You can't go home again. I had this wonderful time with you of three or four times in my life. I felt a kinship to you. And it was, and I realized it's just because you're a fellow Jew and I feel sorry for you.
You know what this was for you? It's like 4 a.m. There's no place open. You go to Denny's and you see a picture of a really good looking omelet and you point to it. And that's when you agreed to do this show. You were pointing to that really good omelet on the menu. And now you're eating the greasy, disgusting.
What's intriguing is And it made this such a rich time for me, was just that I actually had an omelet before I came here for lunch. Because I knew if I had the omelet, then no matter what, however you stumbled around through this thing, and I'd have to listen to one of those horrific jokes, magna cum laude, one of the worst jokes in the history,
Thank
in the
you.
Canon of jokes.
Let me smear it on my face.
No, it was great. I had a great time.
I love you. This is a real gift to me. And how do people not get in touch with you?
The best way not to get in touch with me is go to Slappy Mad. go to KathleenMadigan.com.
KathleenMadigan.com,
because she's really who you want to get in touch with. And bother her, because she enjoys talking to the fans. If you go to LewisBlack.com, and the thing that what I am doing, which we didn't even discuss, but we will next time in our next 6-hour session called David Feldman in Therapy, is that I do after the real reason to go there is I have after every show I do a live stream, so I do an hour show, and at the end I then have the audience that's there and the audience that's on the internet sends
wow.
in questions and answers questions. And I do a Q&A, and then they also send in rants. So I've done 180 some of these, and it goes throughout the world, and it's live. And
you can watch it on your phone. Facebook, or how are you doing it?
Well, now it's on. I've been doing it totally through my website, and you could watch it. People could watch this shit on their phone.
So it's you backstage after a show?
No, I'm on stage in front of that audience. I finish an hour. I do my hour set, and then I do 75 minutes a night, generally, 75 right. to an hour and a half. So instead of doing the last 15 minutes of the show, I've always wanted to do a Q&A, and then it evolved into, I really realized, son of a bitch, these people started sending in rants, and the rants were really good, mm-hmm. some of them, initially, and there weren't a lot. And now they're really catching on so I essentially have a show that's written by my audience.
It's a community.
Yeah.
It is a community.
And it's really very, very, and some of it's serious. I've read stuff that is really deadly serious. Now it's getting to the point that I can start to get it better organized. I mean, it's mostly I'm doing it flying by the seat of my pants. It's 1950s TV. There's two cameras. There's no production values. It's me standing in front of there just talking.
And then the audience in the theater, is there a screen where they can watch this, or they don't?
No, they're watching me.
They're
live.
Watching you, and then you're being handed.
No, I've got it comes on an iPad. They send the questions in. They come in, I throw out, while John is on stage, I go through and I take the questions I'm going to take, I take the rants I'm going to take, I put them on one side of the page, and then I punch it up, and then I go on stage, and at the end I pick it up and we start playing ball.
That's incredible. Okay, I was going to do, after my show, I've been holding on to this joke since you said I do a live stream after every show. So let me do my joke that I have been sitting on top of since you've said that.
Yes.
And I've listened to everything you said afterwards, wondering, when can I do my live stream after a show joke? And now that you've finished,
okay.
Here is my joke. We have to wrap it up because there's a live stream that I've had to do after this show for the past 45 minutes. That is the joke that I've been sitting on since you said.
Wow.
Hey, and Wounded Warrior, is there a charity that you are concerned
with? Yeah, LewisBlack.com. Just get me that money and I'll disseminate it amongst. The Cystic Fibrosis Foundation, the autism program that Robert's involved with, the name of which is escaping me at the moment.
Yeah.
There's the 52nd Street Project, and there's a bunch of other stuff on the website.
And St. Jude's is a good organization.
They are good. We're actually, you know what we're trying to do? I'm trying to put together a comedy fundraiser for St. Jude's.
I will write anything for them.
Okay, great.
Seriously, I as I understand it, they say no to nobody. Yeah. That's my understanding. That is.
They will when I tell them you're going to be a writer. That'll be a no.
No, if you have $5 that you want to make sure is being spent properly.
Yeah,
probably,
yeah. No, they're remarkable. And I'm glad it'll be interesting to see if we can pull it off.
This was a great gift. Thank you, Lewis Black.
It was great. It was a lot of fun.
Thank you.
Thanks, David.
Let's start tape.
Hey, that was great, man.
You're listening to the David Feldman radio program. You sad, pathetic hump.
Well, special thanks to Lewis Black and Brian Stack. This was a great episode. I'm very proud of it. And I'm glad I put them together. Some people thought I should separate them, but it's a great show. And I'm very, very happy and grateful that I was able to get the two of them on by the end of the week. Hey, that's it. If you like the show and you want to thank me, the best way is to copy and paste the link to this episode and share it with your friends. Whatever way you're listening to it, I don't know how you listen to this show. If you're listening to it over at the davidfeldmanshow.com, that's just, you know, copy and paste the link, send it. If you're listening to us on iTunes or Stitcher, there are share buttons. You have to root around, but there are share buttons. And I ask that if you enjoyed this episode and you want to return the favor, please spread it. Spread the love. There's a share button over at iTunes, and spend a minute to look for it, please, and share it with everybody you think would enjoy this. And I can't imagine anybody who wouldn't enjoy this. That's it. That's all I'm asking. Share this. Tell your friends about this episode. The producer of The David Feldman Show is Alex Brazell from the Showbriz Studios in downtown Manhattan. That will do it for us.
Listening to the David Feldman radio program, you sad, pathetic hump.